In 2020, a group of fanboys that love all things pop culture have been accused of murdering a podcast that they did not commit. These fanboys escaped and now are hiding during a pandemic to lay low. Today, still wanted by the fandoms, they survive as fanboys of Forgeon. If you are a fanboy or a fangirl and you have a problem, then you need the F-Team. With your hosts, the Jack Nerd, the Jerky Man, Lieutenant Dan, and of course, Starpool. Welcome to the F-Team Podcast.
I started recording.
All right. Happy holidays. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year, et cetera, et cetera. Welcome to the F-Team Podcast. This is our podcast episode for the month of December. It's our little own Christmas get-together here. I am your host for this evening, the Jerky Man, Jerky Lord, whatever. And I'm going to kick it off by going around the table here with my colleagues and a guest. And I'm going to start with Lieutenant Dan. How are you? And what did you get since the last podcast?
I'm doing all right. And I like to see that I'm not invited on the table. I get my own kid table, apparently.
Well, yeah, well, it's not all that bad. You get to share that table with Satan. Is he still on the line with us?
No, unfortunately.
Oh, okay.
Damn.
Did you get anything video game-wise? Anything at all?
Twist of Metal 3 for the PlayStation. That was really the only thing.
Anything retro gaming-wise?
Not really. Game store doesn't really have anything I want. I pretty much spent all my Christmas money on gun parts. You know, owning an AR epic. Is the same thing as owning a Barbie. You got to customize the fuck out of it.
If I could, I'd get you a Barbie doll that comes with an AR-15.
Comes with an AR-15 attachment.
Hi, I'm Super Killer Barbie. I'm a one hell of a knockout. And she has a freaking pound of C4 in her hand. She tosses it behind her into some sort of enemy lines and just kaboom.
Hey, Chris, Jeez. You technically probably could buy a Barbie and it comes with an AR. Just go to Texas.
Hey,
what state you live
sir,
in.
Sir, that
Deal
is
with
a
it.
Stereotype. I do not appreciate that.
You better.
Boy, you gotta be proud to live in Texas.
Mm-hmm.
Everything's bigger in Texas, including the cocks. Do you have a big cock?
That's what she said.
It's what he thinks. Chicken?
You have a big chicken? Do you choke your chicken?
I do choke a chicken.
Man,
I don't know if it's mine.
Y'all. Y'all are no fun.
Got him.
Oh, man.
Everything's bigger in Texas.
So, this is true. All right, that's pretty cool. All right, next up we have the Jack Nerd. Hanson, what did you get this week and since the last podcast?
Oh, Jesus Christ, man. Fuck.
That's also what she said.
Let's see here. Recently, I got the Wei Zhang Thunder Leader, the KO version of Optimus Prime. It's pretty cool. It looks like a high quality collectible, like, you know, like those 3-0 statues and shit like that. That's what it kind of looks like, but you can actually transform it. It's really that good. The improved parts on this knockoff masterpiece of movie Optimus Prime is insane. Like it looks like the CGI model just came out of the screen, you know. I got some things on pre-order. I got one thing on the way, which is the TFC Tyrant. Needs to hurry the fuck up here so I can actually have it in my goddamn hands. And I just bought Acoustic Wave from Robot Paradise, aka the Fantoys version of Soundwave.
Fantoys!
Damn right. Mm. But nice. Overall, I'm well. I've just been busy, and I just needed, like, this weekend just to be chill, you know, and just chill with buddies, have a good time. On top of that, you know, everyone I know is busy. My girlfriend's busy, so it's a pretty quiet evening, pretty quiet, you know, but I miss
nice.
Her.
It'll be fine.
Yeah, I see her next
It'll
Friday.
It'll be all right.
I see her next yeah. Friday.
I like how Tyler will quote JC, but at the same time, he hates JC's guts.
Hey, whoa. Where'd you get that assumption, bro? Like,
okay, so remember when I thought it'd be funny to bring JC into the old chat that we had, and you were getting annoyed as fuck with him? Don't you remember that?
What? I'm sorry. For some reason... This could just be the 2 to 3 hours of sleep talking. You know, this could be the sleep deprivation or whatever, but I for some reason thought when you said JC, you said you're talking about Jordan. Don't ask me why. It's probably me being sleep deprived.
Oh, well, you should try taking NyQuil the night before you go to bed.
Shit, give me a fucking bottle of that. I'll down that shit like it's fucking cocaine.
No, man, just take 2 pills and drink some eggnog. Mm. That'll knock you out.
Mm. Or do what Chris and I did this past yesterday. Freaking spend almost $30 to $50 of sumos and just pass out.
Oh god. Okay, so yesterday we went to Madison. I had to do some Christmas shopping, and I picked up Hanson, and we drove up to Madison, and we went to Sumo, which is like a Japanese steakhouse, all-you-can-eat sushi buffet type of place. It was so fucking good.
That sounds good.
Oh, we had like crab rangoon, grilled squid.
Mm.
And I had orange chicken with fried rice, but what was the thing you had?
The Sumo Deluxe, which had beef, chicken, shrimp, scallops. And then we also had the that spider roll, and then you had the roll that you liked too.
You had the spider roll, and then I had the it's a type of sushi called ikura.
Yep,
it's really good. Oh,
it was fucking fire yesterday. It was fucking that food was just on point. Oh, so good. So delicious. So delectable.
We ate so much, but it was so fucking worth it. Oh.
Well, that sounds really awesome. But let's get back on the rails because we kind of went off already.
So, anyways, all right. Tyler, Starpool, what did you get this week?
So, first of all, I'm fine. Thanks for asking. Second, the cocaine thing was a joke. So, for all y'all out there, don't take it literal, because don't do drugs. Drugs will fuck your they will fuck you up. They will fuck up your life. Don't do them.
Well, yeah, just take a look at JC.
Yeah, for real. Meth. Oh my god. Ugh. Whoever is related to him, I feel sorry for them.
Fucking derp.
But anyway, as far as what I got a shitload of 3D files, 3D printable files, I should say, and kind of been, you know, kind of hitting it hard with 3D printing, and I kind of got my printer fucked up because somehow, don't ask me how, but somehow, sorry, my dad's being a pain in the ass again. So I don't know how the fuck this happened, but my sleep deprived brain will function properly. The piece of plastic in the bottom of my resin tank got a puncture, and I did not know that that happened. So then the resin leaked out, and it's solidified. Is that the right word? I guess. But it got it dried on my print screen, and I've been chipping away at it, and I've got quite a bit off, but it's nowhere near enough to where it needs to be. But thankfully, I got some more scrapers from Amazon. Got those in yesterday, and I got a screen protector as well that I need to go get from the mailbox. But other than that, you know, I mean, I got the SH Figure Arts Shang-Chi finally, and it's, or Shang-Chi, however the fuck you want to say it.
Shang-Chi.
It's a really good figure. You know, I enjoy him. Let's see. I got some figures from Fortnite. I got that that 3-pack of Beef Boss, Tomato Head, and Peely. And I mostly just wanted Beef Boss, but I also wanted Tomato Head for if I wanted to do some Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles picks, if I get the KO Rebel Tech ones, because I'm not spending $800 on the real ones in total. I'm just not. It's not worth it. So if I did that, you know, that'd be cool. Peely, I don't know what the fuck I'm going to do with him, but hey, if I do something with him, cool. If not, hey, he's there. Something tells me that I got more, but for some reason, I just cannot remember it for the life of me. I don't think I've had tech from the last when we did the last episode. So I got Bad Batch tech, and you know, he's really cool. I had to do some mods to him, but otherwise he's really cool. Let's see, I'm searching around trying to figure it out. I don't think I got the SH Figure Arts the Suicide Squad Harley Quinn in the last show. So I got her recently. I got the Avengers Assemble edition of Hawkeye. Finally, I got myself a Hawkeye because I've been in dire need of a Hawkeye for my Avengers. And I mean, for the most part, it's mostly just 3D printing files. You know, some are accessories, some are like, well, weapons technically count as accessories. Warner Brothers, you woke ass fucks. I'm pissed, but we'll get to that when we get to Asshole of the Month. I got some files for weapons, accessories. I got some weapons racks. I got HK-47 and Commando Droid files to print, and what other spots did I get? I can't remember what all I got, but there were some that I bought, and then there was a lot that I just got for free. Oh, another bit of files I got is the listing said it's a ARC Trooper Captain Fordo, kit that you can print. Like, you got the DC-17 pistols, the holsters, the two different versions of the pauldrons, and for some reason you get a holster belt clip, which doesn't make sense because only Commander Bly has that, and no one else really. But hey, if you want hyper realistic, there you go. I guess, but yeah, you know, and that was a good file. Printed a bunch of pistols and holsters though. But I mean, I'm at the point where I'm rambling now. So it's pretty much that. And one thing I do remember that I got is a lot of paints. Like a lot of paints. Like, I got Tamiya panel liners in black, gray, and brown. I got a flesh wash. I got some paints so that I could make Tamir Morrison's skin tone. And that was cool because I usually don't paint human heads or heads in general unless they're robots, because I suck at painting heads. Yeah. So I think I should stop here before I keep rambling and y'all tell me to shut up. So there you go.
So in other words, you got quite a bit.
Oh yeah. And I mean, I do have some pre-orders, but we'll get to that again with Asshole of the Month, but Cap keeps getting pushed back, and I hope and pray to God that Mark 85 Iron Man and Doctor Strange from Mafex don't get pushed back, but since Cap got pushed back, there's a guarantee that those two will get pushed back as well.
Yep.
All right. Moving on, Corey, one of our guests for this evening. How you been, and what did you get this week?
Hey, good to see you guys again. Good to see you, Corey. I've been good since last time. Yeah, thanks. I've been good since last time. And what I've gotten since then I've got one of these arcade 1-Up Street Fighter 2 arcade games. I don't know if you've seen them, but you can get them at like Walmart.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, I've seen those. Those are pretty cool.
Finally picked one up. Yeah, this one's got Street Fighter 2, but it's got other games like Commando, Ghost and Goblins, Strider, Final Fight. So it's got a nice choice, and then all the different Street Fighters. So, yeah, I picked that up. And then besides that, I've been getting a lot of the Masters of the Universe Origins. I don't know if you've seen any of those. They're like the retro He-Man, but they're articulated more.
Yeah, I got a couple of those in my collection, and I did see the ones from yesterday when I went shopping with Hanson.
Mm-hmm.
I saw Mosquitor and Hordak, but all the other stuff at the store was He-Man stuff I already had.
Well, Canada's a little behind for some reason. I see all the stuff on Facebook that everyone else gets first, but I don't know. I've completed all of the Wave 2 anyway that's come around here, and then some of the limited edition stuff I got. There was the Battle Armor He-Man with the Battle Cat, and they both got like cuts, and he's got like the shinier armor. So I picked that up. Besides that, not too much. Got a few Star Wars things given to me from my brother.
Nice.
Oh, cool. Yeah, I'm not sure. I'm not too good with some of the Star Wars for the names, but yeah, a bunch of vintage stuff anyway. But that's about it.
Oh, is it like the...
So it's 80s? The original vintage Kenner figures?
Yeah.
Nice.
There are a couple of... They were in Empire Strikes Back, I believe. They're snow. I remember them in the snow.
Oh, did you get like
the Rebel Hoth troopers?
Yeah, the Hoth stuff.
It could be. It looks like a stealth jet almost. It's really flat.
Oh, is it gray?
Kind of. I wish I could.
Okay, you might be talking about the snow speeders, which they're technically called air speeders, but because the rebellion actually, well, not on screen, but it said that in canon, they do use them for more than just on the planet Hoth. But I mean, you may as well just keep calling it snow speeder because that's where it was introduced, and that's where that's the only time we see him is on Hoth. So
yeah, that's the snow speeder. That's pretty cool.
Snow speeder, okay.
That's really cool.
Yeah, it's a dope vehicle, not gonna lie.
Yeah, that's pretty neat. But that's about it, yeah.
Well, you're not the only one that got vintage Star Wars stuff yesterday. The stuff I got this week was I got a vintage 81 Kenner Star Wars Boba Fett figure and the Slave One. And then I got the Kenner Ghostbusters Firehouse playset, 100% complete for my collection. And then I got the Cara Dune retro figure from The Mandalorian. So I got those. I did, of course, I sent a picture of it in the chat already. I did get the G.I. Joe Declassified Series Breaker with his bike. And that one's pretty cool. Oh, yeah. Yeah, that one's really cool. I like it. So I'm definitely going to compare it with the vintage 80s breaker with bike because they look good together.
I'm sorry, I gotta say this. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's cool to see a comparison between then and now, but if you're like comparing, like, you know, if you're comparing, like, you know, how accurate each of them are, I mean, there's really no telling because, you know, G.I. Joe has been through so many iterations and all that kind of stuff. Plus, it's kind of like apples and oranges.
Mm.
Wait, just ignore me. I'm sorry.
No, I can hear you.
Yeah. Yeah, I was just more surprised that Chris actually grabbed a classified. And I guarantee. I mean, I know he wants to get a trooper, but once you get more than one, it doesn't stop, and he's gonna fall for the trap.
Chris is finally going down the rabbit hole.
No, I don't know how many times I have to tell you guys
bullshit,
this.
Bullshit, my dude.
I don't know how many times I have to tell you fuckers this. I've said in the past I'm only gonna get Breaker and a Cobra Trooper figure, and that's it because. I told Hansen this, I don't know how many times already. I told him I have plenty of vintage G.I. Joe and Cobra figures and vehicles. I don't need all of the declassified shit. I only need Breaker and a Cobra Trooper, and that's it.
Okay, bud.
I will make an exception for the modern stuff because I prefer the vintage shit. Yeah, you go ahead and sit there and judge my ass all you want, but I'm more than happy to prove you fuckers wrong.
I'm not judging you, dude. I'm not judging. I'm giving you a hard time, man.
Yeah, I mean, I am too, but I'm just saying, you know, once you start collecting classified series, you won't want to stop. Like, as soon as I can, I will be buying 4 Cobra Bats because... Those things are amazing. I saw The Amazing's review on them, and they are, oh my god, they are so fucking amazing. Like, just, oh my god, they're so fucking cool. And
see,
I do have an idea for them, but that's a discussion for another time.
When I finally got a couple of masterpiece figures for Transformers, whether it's a Takara or a KO or a third party, like. With how they are, I'm like, well, shit, this is what I should have started off with Transformers-wise. Because I thought, you know, I'll do Masterpiece if it's a character that I really like and not all of them. If it's just a character that I really like or if it's my favorite, yeah, I'll get Masterpiece or a knockoff or a third-party Masterpiece figure of it. That's fine because when I started, it was all like... War and Fall of Cybertron Chug figures, including the Generations Transformer figures from like 11 and 12 years ago. So, because at first I was very skeptical about Masterpiece, and then when I realized, oh, you can get a knockoff of one at a cheaper price, and I bought one, I was like, oh, wow, this is actually really good for a knockoff. And then eventually I found the Masterpiece Bumblebee figure on sale, and I got him. And so I went down, I've gone down that rabbit hole just a little bit, only to come back out of it. Because, again, I'm picky with who I'm going to get as a Masterpiece figure.
That is actually fair, because, like I'm not really that way with Star Wars, Marvel, and DC. However, when it comes to when it comes to Transformers, after Transformers Prime, after I went down the Transformers rabbit hole with Transformers Prime, I honestly, you know, I thought, okay, these are really cool. And then I got the video game figures, and I'm like, oh, these are cool too. And then when I got the Thundercracker and Skywarp from the generation that are in the video game style, I was like, man, these are not that great. I mean, Thundercracker has loose pieces. Skywarp likes to fall apart. Like, what the fuck is this shit? And not only that, but the Generations figures after the Prime and video game era, they just kind of sucked. They really fucking sucked. So I got rid of them. And even the movie figures weren't all that. Like, I even customized some. And, I mean, I was happy with the results. But it wasn't the paint job alone that let me down. It was the fucking execution.
Mm-hmm.
So after TFP, I dug myself back out of that rabbit hole. And I'm kind of doing that with G.I. Joe as well. Like, I'm only getting the main cast and some troopers, and that's it. I don't need to go any further. I don't need Barbecue. Firefly would be cool, but I don't think I'll get him just because he's not really a main character from what I hear. You know, just stuff like that. So I completely understand where you're coming from. And it's like John said, you know, we're mostly giving a hard time, but I mean, you never know, man. You may think, you know, oh, I'm just going to get a few, and the next thing you know, you are hooked. So.
Well.
Anyway.
I'm already hooked on G.I. Joe and Cobra and all that.
Cobra!
So.
Cobra!
So.
Destro, you fool.
Noble Destro. Suck my dick.
Is it
okay?
Next time, G.I. Joe. Next time, what? G.I. Joe.
Okay, I gotta ask, why the fuck does Starscream and Cobra Commander sound the same? Like, is this the same voice actor?
Yep.
Yeah.
Chris Latta voiced both characters.
Yeah, because gotcha. The studio that did the G1 series also did the G.I. Joe Real American Hero. And a lot of the voice actors on Transformers also worked on G.I. Joe and vice versa. So Chris Latta was a voice actor, but he was also a stand-up comedian. And he was the voice of Cobra Commander and Starscream. Mm. And he was pretty good at it. There used to be this footage of him doing stand-up back in, like, the early 90s. And at one point, he was doing this bit where he was starting to talk funny. And you can hear the Starscream and the Cobra Commander in it. It's unmistakable. Awesome. And I was reading up, like, all the things he did. You know, like TV wise, like apparently he was in a couple episodes of Seinfeld.
Really?
Yeah, I was surprised by that. Because I guess it was one of the characters in Seinfeld. Oh, it wasn't Seinfeld himself. It was his buddy on the show, the tall guy. I think his name is Kramer.
Mm-hmm.
If I remember correctly, the point of the episode was Kramer thought that Chris Latta's character was going to beat him up and rape him on a subway. And
Jesus.
And I think it turned out that, no, his character wasn't going to do that. He was just going to, like, try to mug him. But I guess, I think Kramer got a couple of people to, like, get the jump on him before he could do anything else. And that was one of the last things that Chris Latta did before he passed away. Because the reason why Starscream got killed off kind of early in the movie was because Chris Latta got into trouble with the cops from time to time, so he'd have to spend a night in jail.
Oh, geez.
For whatever he did. Yeah, he was kind of like one of those comedians where he got into trouble off and on. And I think even the director of the original Transformers movie said that they had to rewrite the script. One of the reasons why they had to rewrite the script was because of Chris Latta. And they had to go back and rewrite some of the scripts for the G1 series. Because at that point, it got to be where they could only feature Starscream in one episode, Starscream's ghost, and then that was it. Because Chris Latta, he either kept showing up late for work or he wasn't showing up at all for the recording sessions.
Ah,
Jesus.
Yeah, so there was that kind of stuff. But before all that shit was going on, when they first started the first season, he was there, and everyone that was on the cast said that he was great to work with and he was really funny. And and then I think I also remember reading that he got inducted into the Transformers Hall of Fame and his daughter accepted it in his honor.
Nice.
Mm-hmm.
That's very cool.
Yeah, I didn't know he had a part, but because I know the guy that does the voice of Shipwreck, he also does the voice of Springer on Transformers.
I got better things to do tonight than die.
And then so Shipwreck steps in and be like, "Why the hell do you sound like me?"
So, I do have a question. If there was any kind of a new video game or series for G.I. Joe, since I already forgot his name, the voice both Starscream and Cobra Commander. What was it again?
Chris Latta.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm bad with names. So because Chris Latta voiced both Starscream and Cobra Commander, and Steve Blum voiced Starscream and Transformers Prime, wouldn't it be in a way poetic if he voiced Cobra Commander? I mean, yeah, this is just
if he can do it right.
Yeah.
But yeah, I know there's. Go ahead, Tyler.
No, I'm sorry. I was just going to say, I think he could, like, if not him just doing a Starscream voice, maybe he could, like, do a Starscream voice, but, like, but with, like, a higher pitch, if that makes sense.
Mm. Well, I know there's some other voice actor that just came out doing the voice of Starscream for that HasLab Sky Striker backing project, because they did a video a couple weeks ago where they made it look like Cobra Commander. They made it look like Cobra Commander took over Hasbro and was trying to make the deal for the HasLab Sky Striker more enticing by adding more stuff to it at the last minute. Which apparently it worked. So, and the guy that does the voice of Starscream, I don't remember his name, but like, or Cobra Commander, it's like, yeah, he could easily do it in the spirit of Chris Latta, and it would sound pretty good. Like, if they did a G.I. Joe show that was a continuation of A Real American Hero, they could easily have this new guy do Cobra Commander.
Yeah, well, I mean, I was meaning, like, either... I wasn't really thinking of a continuation, like, just... Because, I mean, then again, I'm not really that big in G.I. Joe, isn't there, like, multiple different comic storylines?
Just the comic and just slightly different.
Yeah, because there's G.I. Joe, Real American Hero, and then there was G.I. Joe Extreme, and then another was G.I. Joe Resolute. I know there's a couple other ones, but I can't think of their names. Corey, do you know what those ones are?
Well, I know the cartoon was way different. Like, nobody died in the cartoon. But then, yeah, Real American Hero, the comic, was Larry Hama. And then, yeah, I'm not sure, the Resolute, or it was Valor versus Venom. I'm not sure some of the other ones. Guys, and Storm Shadow comic. It was a whole bunch of different G.I. Joe ones once they switched to IDW.
Okay.
Yeah, so there's been different, like, timelines and continuities.
Yeah, but most people go with the comic storyline because it's a little more in-depth. It gives a backstory for Cobra Commander and, you know, Snake Eyes and Storm Shadow. It's kind of where the movie took some of their ideas from Snake Eyes.
Okay. I just wish that, I know I've said this before, but I'll say it again. I just wish with, like, the 86... Was it 86 or 87 when the G.I. Joe animated movie came out?
You know what? You got me. I'm not sure. I think it was 87.
Yeah, it was supposed to be 86, but then it was changed to 87. I like that movie. I still do, but I still prefer the idea of Cobra Commander being like a former businessman of some kind, and then becomes a leader of a terrorist organization. I still like that idea more.
Me too. More powerful, right? Than they make.
Yeah, it's kind of more grounded too, and it's still fun. It has like a James Bond feel to it. But on the other hand, I guess the Cobra Law thing is okay. I mean, you got to have some kind of a plot for a movie.
And that's kind of like with Taskmaster in the Black Widow movie, you know?
Go ahead.
No, you go ahead. I'm sorry.
Well, I don't know why I'm so, like, with G.I. Joe, you expect it to be so realistic when Marvel and other things are so, you know, animated. But for me, when I was growing up, it went from Masters of the Universe, which was kind of more... animated, I guess, more make-believe, and then you kind of grow into G.I. Joe, which was more realistic for some reason. But then once G.I. Joe got a little bit, you know, they had some characters that flew, and, you know, it got a little bit weird with the Cobra Law. The colors got a little funky. But, you know, when you look at Marvel and stuff, we have no problem accepting it there, so I don't know why we had a problem with it with G.I. Joe. When we look back on those characters now, like Serpentor as adults, they're pretty damn, like, they're pretty awesome.
Yeah,
I'd like to see them classified.
Like, I think I kind of don't care for the idea of Cobra Commander being, like, some kind of a lizard man. Like, if the movie just had him... as the, like, he was like that businessman car dealership, wasn't it? Like, he worked at a car dealership in the comics.
Yeah, that's what it was. Yeah.
If they had that storyline for him in the movie, and then still had the Cobra Law thing, I would have been okay with that. You know, kind of bring something from the comic books and something new for the movie.
Well, when they brought that, what was it, Batman Begins, they made it realistic, even though when it was sort of following the Batman story. They should have did that with G.I. Joe, just made it all kind of like realistic military-wise and
Yeah, with some like sci-fi fiction type of stuff in it, you know, to a certain degree. Because that was the great thing about Batman Begins, was it was realistic. Because it was realistic and it showed his origins. And I want to say kind of the same thing with the 78 Superman, but that was more sci-fi and fantasy-ish. But definitely Batman Begins, it was more grounded in reality and yet still to a certain level of fiction.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I think that would have worked, but who knows? Like, Snake Eyes was a good movie, I thought, but it was, I don't know, it wasn't G.I. Joe. It was just more or less a ninja movie, so.
Yeah, that's what it felt like, too, because I was telling Hanson this. I said I would have liked it if it had been more like an origin story of Snake Eyes, but also like some kind of a prequel right before G.I. Joe, Real American Hero, like before both the comic book and the animated series, like a prequel that could go in either direction and either timeline.
Mm-hmm.
But you're right. It does just seem like some kind of a ninja movie, and that's it.
Are we talking about the new G.I. Joe movie?
Snake Eyes, yeah.
Oh yeah. And it's funny. The one thing that kind of bothered me by toward the end of that movie was that you finally get the reveal of the outfit at the end of the movie. It's like they talked about this movie a couple years ago, and it was supposed to be like this massive reboot and new undertaking for G.I. Joe, and then it just completely went into a completely different direction.
Yeah, I agree. It wasn't G.I. Joe. It was just, if you look at it as a standalone movie, it's not bad. But if you're looking for something G.I. Joe, yeah, it wasn't. It's just that, like you said, that ending.
See, that's kind of the exact same thing that people said back in the day and still to this day about Alien 3. They like it as a standalone movie, but people don't like it as a sequel to the first two movies.
Right.
But I told Hanson, like, it should have been a prequel that serves both before the G.I. Joe Marvel comic books and A Real American Hero, where you see how Snake Eyes starts out, and then, like, he at the very end, he gets an offer to join G.I. Joe.
Well, technically speaking, in the comics, he was part of G.I. Joe, but he was a commando. And then after what happened with his throat and his face, he really donned the mask and that of being pretty much Snake Eyes himself. I mean, I don't understand why they couldn't do something like that and give it more of a reason why he didn't talk. Instead of just having him talk throughout the entire movie, I think it would have been better if something bad happened to him, like at least his vocal cords or something get all fucked up. And I know also that both Snake Eyes and Scarlet actually end up together in the comics, too. So what happened to any of that exposition and whatnot?
You know, I haven't seen the Snake Eyes movie, but if I had to say why they didn't take that route, it's probably because maybe it'd be too gruesome for younger audiences. I mean, that's just my guess, but maybe they thought, well, this is pretty damn dark for kids to be watching, so we'll have to kind of find a workaround or something like that. I don't know.
Right.
I'm just guessing here.
Right.
You might be right. There was no blood at all in the movie, really.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. If I was going to do a G.I. Joe movie, I would, with the experience that I've had and knowing that there are fans of the franchise, like Chris and Corey, I could probably make it more of that war, that right type of war-esque movie, like, you know, Cobra Troopers actually getting shot and dying and stuff like that. Maybe even like a sacrifice from a G.I. Joe or something like that, because in war itself, people die, and it's like, oh yeah, I just got a little bit of scratch, I'm okay. It's like, no, that does not, that's not how war is supposed to work. I mean, yeah, you did kind of see that in Rise of Cobra, but they had that too much of that too techie stuff. Like why can't we get a G.I. Joe movie with actually more of this, like, real-world aesthetic? Like, it could be grounded in this reality we live in instead of just having...
The first fight to Saving Private Ryan.
yeah, like something like from Saving Private Ryan. Yeah, exactly, but not as... Not like ripping that off, but at least something along those lines where people actually actually there's blood, like, you know, there's someone who gets a scratch right on their face or something, or then blood comes out, or they get wounded or something, but not to an extent where it's like to that R level of people dying type thing, like, you know, bodies getting blown apart and shit like that. Or I mean, you could be like something out of Quentin Tarantino and stuff like that, where there's blood everywhere. You know, I mean, I don't know. I'm just putting my two cents in.
I think that'd be fine. Like, there's a lot of soldiers that are fans of G.I. Joe and vets. I see a lot of them in the Facebook group. So, I mean, they would have problem with that.
As long as it doesn't trigger like a PTSD for them and stuff like that.
I've been kind of mentally playing with the idea of some kind of a prequel story that would, at the very end of it, would lead right into the very beginning of the first episode of G.I. Joe, A Real American Hero, the animated series. Because I like the idea of, like, seeing how people get into G.I. Joe and then have a story play out where it leads into the very first scene of the first episode from A Real American Hero. It would be the equivalent of hey, Tyler.
Tyler,
yeah.
What are you working?
What are you doing?
Sanding.
No, we can hear that.
Sorry, I'll just do it later. Didn't know it was going to be that loud.
And then, because it would be like Rogue One led right into the original Star Wars movie. And I've always loved that idea, how it can just blend right into the very beginning of the original Star Wars movie.
Right,
Because I like that idea. But I've also liked the idea of, like, I think personally it'd be cool if Corey did something like that in his stop motion style. And again, have the end of that lead right into the very first scene of A Real American Hero.
That'd be really cool, yeah.
Yeah, I would love to see that, but the thing is, like, trying to come up with a story. And also, because stop motion takes a while, it's like, okay, you got to come up with some kind of a story, and it can't be too long. So it's like, oh, okay, we got to figure out some kind of common ground here.
Yep. Like, I mean, I like what you're talking about, Chris. I really do. I like the idea. It would be something to see. I mean, if I were to go about it, it would be like that origin where, you know, it would have to start off with, like, mainly with General Hawk, who actually starts the G.I. Joe organization, and they would have to pick the best of the best from Navy SEALs, Marines, Army Special Forces, Army Rangers, et cetera, et cetera. Then they would have to do that worldwide thing to actually bring in other foreign allies and be like kind of like how we have NATO, where NATO is the military organization, the equivalent of NATO, but even more secretive, more challenging to get into that type of role.
That'd be cool. I think a good team. Too. Did you guys hear they're doing the Scarlet TV series?
No, I did not.
I did not.
They're talking. Yeah, so I don't know if that's going to be the same actress or same or what, but I don't know. I just saw that pop up on Facebook, so it might not even be true. But
what website has the article?
I'd have to get back to you because I'm using my phone right now.
Hold on, I'll check it out.
Because usually if it's Well, IGN is usually very accurate. Screen Rants, most of the time they are, but sometimes they can be a bit far-fetched. Okay. You know, so it just depends.
Okay. Hold up, guys. Hold up, guys. I'll be right back.
I'm just trying to see if I can find it.
I think they had the same actress from the movie.
The girl who plays Scarlet in Snake Eyes, right?
No, it actually. No, I think it was the one from the other two.
Oh, the Rise of Cobra?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which made me think that they just grabbed a picture from anywhere for the article. Who knows?
But the picture that I think I know what the article you're talking about. I was trying to look it up, but it was actually that was from Retaliation. That was Lady J.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that was technically Lady J in that photo of the article. But I mean, back on the topic of that origin idea, I mean that would be something.
Yeah.
Because there's not a lot of build up when it comes to the origin of how G.I. Joe truly really started. I mean, in Rise of Cobra, it was like, oh yeah, this is like you don't ask to join G.I. Joe. G.I. Joe asks you, and they say that it was General Hawk said that it was that the there were the Alpha Dogs, or stuff like that. Yeah. So there would have to be. But then there would have to be more to it. Like, where do they get their funding? I mean, it's going to be a worldwide organization, it'd have to be a worldwide funding for a type of military operation like that. But then again, nobody wants to. Well, go ahead, Corey. My bad.
No, I'm just saying it would be cool to get into that, just the whole recruiting part of it, too, and how they, you know. How they operate secretly and how they started.
Yeah, like if I were to do it, let's say, you know, General Hawk picks the very first, maybe like I could see the movie opening up like this, where him and higher ranking generals from all four branches and to start at a United States or Canada, mainly North American level, right? And then they're sitting down around a table like, all right, we're going to start this organization called G.I. Joe. And then what they would do from there is carry on, like, starting the very basic principles of the organization. But maybe we could see, like Duke going into a recruiting office and joining the United States Army or something like that. And then we see the story build on from there, him being a soldier, and possibly all of a sudden, like, it just follows him. And then the next thing you know, he is with G.I. Joe, where there's Snake Eyes, there's Scarlet, there's certain characters already there that were already part of the organization. And then Cobra would actually have to be even more worldwide as a terrorist organization on top of that.
That's what people want.
What's that?
Huh?
Go ahead, Corey. You were saying something.
I was just saying that's what people want. You know, they just killed Duke off too quick, you know, in the movie there. They could have spent a lot more time just building all those characters because there's a lot of characters that people love in the early years of Joe. So why not get into the origins of all of them?
Oh, yeah, definitely, definitely. Like that would be kind of the G.I. Joe reboot I would want to see. And what if they actually set it more into the 80s, though? That would be something very unique, like how they did with Bumblebee. Wow.
Yeah.
Oh. That would make it even more unique, but, you know, it would have to have that real world principles and maybe have, you know, some characters that actually fabricate and build some certain vehicles where you could actually see a actual 80s era Sky Striker or something like that implanted into that world.
Or a proper Cobra Trooper, you know, would be nice.
Yeah, a proper Trooper or the Cobra. Looks like a Warthog, A-10 Warthog, that one plane they have. Imagine that being a dark blue, dark navy blue, maybe with some black highlights with the Cobra logo right on the wings or something like that.
It's, yeah. That'd be great.
I mean the aspects of that could be taken to an entire new level if actually someone was actually given the right proper care. The proper care of that franchise.
Yeah. Yeah, it'd have to be someone like a good fan involved with it.
A fan or someone who just understands the lore of it. Like sometimes I think with the whole Transformers franchise, I feel like someone who understands the lore, who could be a true fan, could actually make a great story and a better origin for the entire Transformers, like how they did with the Bumblebee movie. And, you know, even though that the new one's been pushed back to 2023 now, which is insane, it just makes me wonder, like, if it's being pushed back, there's clearly something that wasn't truly done right in the first place, you know?
Yeah.
Because it was supposed to come out next year of 22.
Mm-hmm. And then if it does well, then they can rewrite. They could get into, you know, redoing the movies in present, you know?
Oh, definitely. I mean, don't get me wrong, the Michael Bay 07 film is still a pretty decent film. But I feel like that it's time to let go of the Bayverse of Transformer movies and move on to something more fresh, more captivating than recycling the same thing over and over again. That's why Bumblebee felt like more like a reboot than a prequel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. And it really does depend on, like, you know, it really does depend on stuff like, you know, sorry, I'm trying to think of what I'm trying to say. I think if fans if fans were in charge of you know, stuff like, you know, Transformers, G.I. Joe, Star Wars, Marvel, DC, that kind of thing, I think a lot of the movies that suck from those franchises would be a lot better. Kind of like when you were talking about Transformers, like with Bumblebee, like it could have been, so much better, like the Bumblebee movie, because, you know, I mean, you have these designs you can play around with and not make them look like walking junk piles, you know, and that kind of thing, well, maybe not with Marvel, because a lot of their movies are good, but even for the second ones from Marvel, and, you know, and as much as I enjoy the DC movies, you know, they're still all over the place. Like, have someone come in and write stuff that flows in terms of the continuity, because as of right now, there's no continuity at all with the DC movies, and I love the movies, but they piss me off because there's no continuity there. And then, like, with Star Wars, you know, the sequels, it could have been so much better if they were written better and planned ahead instead of just jumping into making a movie and just half-assing it and winging it. And also switching directors in the middle of the trilogy and then switching back.
Are we talking about the sequel trilogy or the prequel trilogy?
Sequels, dude.
Okay, I completely my brain kind of just went kind of.
Nah, it's all right. I mean, I kind of went a little
retarded there for a second.
Nah, it's all right, because, like, don't get me wrong, I am talking about the sequels, because I love the prequels. I mean, as corny as the writing can be, and as memeified as those movies have become, I wouldn't change a thing, honestly. But sequels, there's a lot I would change.
The thing is about those of the sequel movies is that, for one, when the rights were handed over to Disney, they had no logical sense of how the hell a lightsaber worked, clearly. And on top of that, it's just that the sloppy writing they had, and they tried to insert some sort of intergalactic narrative that no one didn't really give a fuck about. All we want is Star Wars. Star Wars, not like war. It's a war, right? You're fighting against someone. You're not like just jerking off and doing stupid shit. You know, that's just the way how I felt about it. And you know, and then also they made Luke Skywalker kind of look like a pansy because he's supposed to be one of the greatest Jedi. They could have handled Luke a hell of a lot better. So it probably could have been a better movie on top of that.
Exactly, because here's the thing. Mark Hamill even said that even if Luke went into exile, he wouldn't have done it for more than 6 months. Like, after 6 months or less, he'd be back out there. He wouldn't be hiding for, like, 25 to 30 years. Like, that's a bit ridiculous.
Yeah.
But you know, that's what I'm saying. Like, it is partly Disney, but it's also, you know, Kathleen Kennedy. God, I wish she would just get fired already, or they'd let her go already, but oh well. you know, it's because of Bob Iger and Kathleen Kennedy, you know, and, mm-hmm. you know, and it's because of them that we have this giant sloppy ass written trilogy, you know. I mean, I'm not saying that, you know, for those who enjoy it shouldn't enjoy it. You know, if you enjoy it, you enjoy it. I just have a hard time trying to enjoy it, mostly because of the inconsistency and Ray being a fucking Mary Sue and everything like that. Like they kept going back and forth between she's a Kenobi, now she's a Palpatine, now she's a Kenobi, now she's a Palpatine. Like, Jesus Christ, J.J. Abrams, pick one already.
Yeah,
and that was like, the problem. Like, he even confirmed it in an interview that he couldn't make up his mind, so he just at the last second went, all right, she's a Palpatine. You can't do that. You got to plan this shit out. And they didn't do that. So that's why the sequels flopped.
That's one thing I hate about the sequels is like they revolved around the story about Palpatine when we all know that he actually did die at the end of Return of the Jedi. And they didn't really explain of how he truly came back. Yeah,
actually, they did
alchemy and stuff like that. But at the same time, I mean, it's like he died. He died. That means Anakin's sacrifice was for nothing, knowing that
exactly.
He still survived. So it just felt like they were totally oblivious to the story. They thrown the pickled Snoke idea out of the fucking door too. It's like, well, okay, what is this? Is this Star Wars, or are we just making up, or is this called Makeup Wars or some shit like that? I mean, it could have been handled better, but
that's what I'm saying. If fans were in charge of this, or if they took more creative leverage from fans, like with G.I. Joe, Transformers, all that kind of stuff that we were talking about earlier, then all the Star Wars movies, even though Marvel had a lot of good movies, they still had some kind of and ones. Those and ones would have been a lot better. The DC movies would have more, at least better, near perfect continuity. And, you know, the Bayverse movies wouldn't be such a wreck towards the end. And then, you know, I mean, I may not have... It's been a while since I've seen the first two G.I. Joe movies, and I haven't seen Snake Eyes. But from what I'm hearing right now, if fans had more creative leverage over the production, they would probably have made much better movies for G.I. Joe as well. But I do, and don't get me wrong, like, I do think fans should have a say in it. However, you also have to be careful about that, because there are some fans that say they want this, and then some fans that say, no, don't do this, do this. And it's like, you know, it can sometimes can be a very fan wars volatile, centered kind of thing to happen. I mean,
it kind of worked with Sonic and the redesign they did for him.
Well, yeah, but I'm saying for those, because Because here's the thing, man. Before the sequels came out, Star Wars was not as toxic as it was now. I mean, and even if it was toxic, it wasn't nearly as toxic. I mean, thank God it's calmed down, and hopefully it'll stay fucking calm. But back in 2014, when Age of Extinction was coming out, oh my God, dude, everyone was so fucking butthurt about Transformers. Like, they piss and moan about every little thing. It's like, it's just a fucking movie. If you don't like it, go back to your G1 or your Armada or your Energon or whatever, you know, or your video games. And what I'm basically trying to say here is, if creators and directors and all the kind of stuff of these franchises that we love made movies about them and they had fan input, you got to be careful for those toxic people, because otherwise, again, they could start some pretty sizable fan wars, and then they're not going to want to take advice from fans or anything like that. They're just going to be like, well, they're just fucking acting crazy now. We're going to do our own shit.
That's why you have to have a neutral fan who has respect for all Transformers, Star Wars, G.I. Joe franchises.
Exactly.
That's how something like that would have to be done. Is a neutral fan, like for me example, I mean the first three Michael Bay movies. Yeah, the second one had problems, but the first and third are great movies. The Bumblebee movie, my generation one was Transformers Armada. I mean, there are certain, and then I watched G1. I watched even some of the I watched Transformers Victory, which is the Japanese series. I mean, you know, we as fans, we have to have respect for, even if it's just the most messed up stuff, like in Age of Extinction, the Snake Eyes movies, the sequel trilogy of Star Wars. I mean, all of that we've seen, right? We've seen that stuff, and we want to know what could be improved. This is why it feels like we're having a great discussion on these topics, whether it be G.I. Joe and Star Wars, and regarding with Transformers. And I mean, and I can see why this is really not a noted show, because it feels like we're trying to express how we feel about this type of stuff, because we have so much respect for these types of things. Like, you know, Corey, clearly loves G.I. Joe. And watching the stop motion is incredible on top of that. And Tyler, you are very passionate about Star Wars. And, you know, Chris, he's all over the board. And Dan, I have no idea what the fuck is going on with him. So,
Dan's quiet. He's the sound wave of all of us.
He is.
I think he fell asleep. That's all right.
You know, I mean, granted, I was asleep. I am still a bit sleep deprived, but I almost nodded off on the couch, not going to lie. But, I'm awake. But, yeah, I mean, don't get me wrong. I completely understand what you're saying, dude. Like, and I fully agree. But that's what I'm saying. Like, unless there are mutual fans with mutual respect and everything like that, like I said, you got to be careful, or there will be fan wars. And like, you know, I'm not saying that it's going to happen all the time or anything like that. But, like,
well,
you know, hear me out, because some people may say they have, like, you know, some people may say that they're civilized and then turn around and show a completely different face. So that's what I'm saying, like, whether it's, you know, mutual fans, fans that are toxic, fans that are just casual, whatever, all across the board. Sometimes, not all the time, maybe not all the time, but a lot of the times, you have to be careful when taking inspiration from, you know, the source materials and the fans and all that kind of stuff. Because
Kevin Smith with He-Man, he took a lot of crap for what he did with He-Man. Not complaining.
I haven't seen He-Man, because I think He-Man is the dumbest franchise ever. I don't care. Fight me on it. I don't give a shit. It's my opinion. I stick with it. But
it's exactly what you're talking about.
But that's what I'm talking about. Like, you know, some creators, you know, if whether they take inspiration from fans or the source material, you got to be careful either way. You know, however way you create something like that, if you're not careful enough, people will chew you up and spit you out.
That's why I have to tell those people to go fuck themselves.
True, but creators can't, well, in a way they can, but they can't just outright say go fuck yourself, because then they may either get fired or fans will be like, cancel him.
Well, I was just gonna put my two cents in this and we can move on. But you know, that's why there's fans like us out there that actually have respect for these franchises. And if we could
get
picked to fucking do this type of shit, actually write a script or have at least a good idea and have a writer's room of people that have that same respect, then we wouldn't be Transformers G.I. Joe and Star Wars fans wouldn't be in the type of uncivilized world that everyone lives in, because there are some people like that just are hardcore G1. There are people that are like hardcore G1, meaning hardcore G1 for both G.I. Joe and Transformers, because that's the generation one. And then there's some that like and enjoy the movies. And then you got Star Wars. You got people that hated the prequel trilogy but love the original trilogy. There's people that love the prequel trilogy, hate the original trilogy. But I think
I'm sorry to cut you out. Well, you know what? Never mind. Go ahead.
And then I'm pretty sure we could all agree that the sequel trilogy was pretty much dog shit, which could have been better handed if they had George Lucas be part of it in some shape or form, at least writing the scripts or at least having the ideas to make things flow better, then maybe the sequel trilogies would have been actually really somewhat decent, especially if it was written by George Lucas.
Well, that's the unfortunate part. He even prepared us. He even did a script for the last three movies, and they just threw it away.
Well, that for one, then he should have never gave his franchise away in the first place.
But the thing is if he didn't sell his company, he would actually lose money. I can't remember how much exactly, and I can't remember what predicament he was in. But he was in this kind of spot where if he didn't sell his franchise, his company to Disney or someone, then he would have lost a lot of money. That's all I remember. But that's why, and it is, and I know what you may be thinking. Yes, it is bullshit, and yes, it does suck. But you know, I mean, how do I put this? The fucking government sucks, you know.
I wouldn't say it's a government issue. It's more of creative control, is what it is.
Well,
Disney wanted the franchise. They bought the franchise. Then they completely turned everything that George Lucas built and turned it upside down into complete ridiculousness. I mean, yeah, Force Awakens was decent. Rise of Skywalker, I mean, The Last Jedi was like, wait, what the fuck is this? Then Rise of Skywalker just got all fucking confusing. There, I said it.
I mean, you pretty much hit the nail on the head with that.
Yeah.
And the other thing, too, is that, you know, even George Lucas said there's nothing new and unique. Like, you know, with the originals, you know, yeah, you have the different planets with the Earth elements, with each planet, but then you go to the prequels and you have a lava planet, which is Mustafar. You have, if you want to slip in some Clone Wars here and there, you got Christopsis, which is a planet entirely made of crystals. You know, just different stuff like that. Like, there were actually cool and unique and different locations that didn't just look like spots of Earth. And that's another thing I don't like about the sequels is like, you know, they wanted as much practicality as possible, that they didn't think, okay, well, how about we think of some cool, new and unique planets that we could do practical effects for? Oh, another one. Felucia. Felucia is another good one. Salukami. There's another one. You know, I could go on and on here, but we would be here all night. So
let's move on.
But, yeah, we talked about this way too fucking long. Speaking of which, do we even have notes?
No, we don't.
No, we're just winging it.
We're winging it.
I didn't know for sure.
No, we're just winging it. So,
what did you need from me?
What?
Did you need something from me?
No, you're just wondering if you fell asleep or if you were still there or something. And you're just quiet.
I'm doing other stuff.
We're just make sure you're alive.
Unfortunately, I still am.
So, Hanson, you want to check in and see where Jordan's at?
Yeah, I'll shoot him a message, and because he did message me, and he is at a family thing. I'll see if he's done yet. And that was about 6:55 when he messaged me. So,
and I hope he is done. I mean, we could use some jokes up in here, other than my life.
Okay, you want some jokes? I can tell some jokes.
Shit.
Two Jews walk in a bar.
Oh, shit.
My brother would appreciate that joke.
I'm sorry. I just had to get that.
One dropped a penny.
What's that?
I said one dropped a penny.
Oh my god.
And the other one died trying to get it.
Oh my god. Oh, shit. That's so fucked up. That's fucked up.
So, I guess my question to you guys,
Peener?
I don't know who said Peener, but so what are you guys looking forward to next year? Like figure-wise, movie-wise, what are you looking forward to?
Movie-wise, Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness, but probably more so Deadpool 3, because Deadpool will finally be in the MCU by then, which I'm happy about.
Is there really a Deadpool 3 coming out? Is there, like, even...
They're supposedly writing it.
It probably will be until 2023 that when it comes out, though, if you think about it.
Honestly, at this point, if 2023 is a maybe, possibly 2024 or 2025 is my personal estimate. I could be wrong, and I hope I am, but I don't know. I mean, we'll just have to kind of wait and see and play it by ear, but figure-wise... Just anything I got on pre-order right now, anything that's went up for pre-order but I couldn't buy because I'm not working. They've got Book of Boba Fett Black Series figures of Boba himself and Fennec Shand. Let's see, they've got Dr. Evazin and Poon Dababa. Like, originally I wasn't thinking about getting them, but after seeing how good they are, I'm actually tempted because, like, I could use not only some more characters for, like, background setups and everything like that, but, like, maybe some criminals and some aliens, you know? I'd love to get a Greedo, but unfortunately Greedo's been pain in the ass to get. Like the normal episode 4 version of Greedo, not that Kenner style green suit one. Don't get me wrong, it looks fine. It's just, it's not something I would get. Just different stuff like that. I got the SHF Deadpool on pre-order from Dork Sided Toys. I can't really think of anything else because, like, I probably have like a. I also have the Mafex Hush Huntress, and we'll kind of get to her with Asshole of the Month. But But, you know, I am looking forward to that figure. And Loki, John, I think you and I are both excited for the upcoming Infinity War Loki.
Yeah.
I mean,
I gotta do that pre-order. I gotta figure out where that pre-order is. But,
dude, if you pre-order him from AmiAmi, I mean, you only have to pay until you know
when he comes out.
So I mean, you have almost you have like slightly under a year until you have to pay for that sucker. So, I mean. Will it get pushed back? Possibly, because I've seen the pushback almost every fucking MCU figure out there. Yep.
Got it.
Will it be worth it? Hell yeah.
Yeah, I know. What about you, Chris? What are you looking forward to next year?
I got plans to finally get a hold of a Cobra Terra drone playset for my collection.
You finally got plans figured out?
Yeah, I got a plan figured out. It'll be a while before it comes home, but I got a plan for it. So I'm gonna get that, and that's gonna get a couple of the second wave of the Mandalorian retro figures coming out next year. And I get to try to get some more vintage G.I. Joe and Star Wars figures. What else? Probably get a few things at Dairy Con in April.
Mm-hmm.
And then, what else do I want to get? And then probably a couple more things for my train set. And then that's probably about it.
Nice. What about you, Corey?
For me, I don't know. I might slow down a bit. I want to start displaying some of my stuff. So I might look for some cabinets to display. And then I'm looking forward to possibly... As for TV, I heard that Goonies was going to be following suit to like Cobra Kai and doing like a TV series.
Yeah, I heard about that. Yeah.
Yeah, we talked about that on this podcast a while back.
Yeah.
Oh, really? I just heard it recently.
The article I read was it was either going to be a TV series or a sequel. And the guy that is a producer on the Goldbergs, he and a friend of his, they figured out a story for a sequel. And they had a picture of like some piece of artwork that they hired somebody to draw for them to promote the idea. And we talked about it a while back on the podcast, but it sounds like it could be a good idea, because I do know years ago I read online that Cartoon Network was actually thinking about doing an animated series based off of the Goonies, which would have been cool, but I guess for reasons unknown it never came to fruition and they canceled the project. But it would have been a cool idea, though. But, you know, I've said this before and I'll say it again. The Goonies is one of those movies where it's like, you, depending on how well it does, it's like you better figure out a really creative way to make a good sequel to this or just leave it as is.
Right.
You know, it may or may not need a sequel, and chances are it sure as hell doesn't need a remake. You know, it's like, I give this example every time. It's like trying to make a classic movie. It's like trying to remake Casablanca. There's no way in hell you could try to remake Casablanca. There's no way in hell because it's perfect the way it is. It came out at the right time.
Mm-hmm.
It's the equivalent of trying to go back and remake the Mona Lisa exactly the way Leonardo da Vinci did it. Mm-hmm. There's no way in hell you can do that. Same way with these classic movies. You can't remake them. You know, I hate to say this, but look at what's that?
It's something slightly different, though, because you got a movie like Karate Kid or Goonies where they're all child actors, and now you got a chance to make like a TV series where they're adults, you know, which is something that seems to be doing fairly well with Cobra Kai. So, I mean, in that aspect, it might be a good idea. But as a sequel, I don't know. They kill everything when they do it into a movie.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, and, you know, I hate to throw this out there, but it's the truth. You know, they did that all-female Ghostbusters remake, and look how that turned out. You know, it's like, you can't remake Ghostbusters. It's the same thing with Ghostbusters. It's perfect the way it is. It doesn't need to be remade. Nope. And that became a disaster. So now, here was the other thing that we were going to talk about. We almost forgot. How many of us here went and saw Ghostbusters Afterlife?
Well, obviously,
I have not seen that one yet.
Oh my god! If you guys like Ghostbusters, including the first two movies, and not the female version from 2016. You will enjoy Afterlife. It was amazing.
That one was the best one.
The female one?
Okay, I gotta say this up front. I used to think that the female Ghostbusters was good, but now I think it's absolute dog shit. Like, I don't know why the fuck I thought that one was good, because it's really not. And hello, Chris Hemsworth is a great actor, but holy shit, his character sucked.
It's not that they're bad actors or actresses. They're all good. It's just the script and the dialogue was horrible.
I wasn't saying that. I didn't say that as in Chris Hemsworth sucked in the movie. His acting was great. I'm saying,
his character.
Exactly, his character fucking sucked. And it what's funny is, I mean, isn't it true that Chris Hemsworth usually does movies if the script is good or something like that?
Yeah, usually, but they're doing that just to have some money on the side, though. But what I'm saying is that everyone that was in that movie, they're not bad actresses or actors. They're good. It's just the script, the plot, and their dialogue was written badly for them.
It was terrible for the dialogue.
Yeah, so you have a good cast. It's just the script that was made for them. The script itself that was made for them is bad. That's the difference. Because when everyone said, oh, this movie fucking sucks and this and that, no, because people were bitching about, oh, if you say it sucks, that must mean you're sexist. No,
right.
They're not saying it's bad because it's being sexist or anything like that. It's just the plot itself is bad. It's nothing personal against the cast. Nobody asked for this. If you want to do it as a comic book, that's fine. But it clearly did not work as a movie.
No, it didn't. And then just to piggyback off of that, I mean, you know, I remember watching that movie, and it was just, you know, I used to be in Tyler's predicament. I thought it was good, but then I look back on it. I mean, man, I was young and naive when I saw that movie, because it lacks something that the original Ghostbusters have. Like, it was lacking. I think, like, what Chris was saying, like, the writing, the dialogue and stuff had to be part of all of that to make it as of a much of a complete rotting corpse of horse shit that spawned from that movie. And I'm glad Afterlife was that Ghostbusters movie that everyone wanted to fucking see, because, I mean, Before we went, both me, my girlfriend, and I, I rewatched the first and second one, and she saw the first and second one very first time, so she knew who of who was, and then when she went there, she fucking loved it. When we was what, you, me, Chris, you and me, and you had Quinn, and of course Haley was with us, dude. It was a fucking amazing night. And on top of that, just watching that movie was just even better, you know?
Yeah, because this plot was done using elements from previous scripts that either other people had written or Dan Aykroyd himself had written. And it was a great way to bring the original cast and a new cast together. It was done perfectly.
And on top of that, the way they dedicated to Harold Ramis, a.k.a. Egon, you know, the way they dedicated that to him was perfect. There's nothing better than that of the reasoning why he did what he did was to pretty much save the world. And then his family figuring out why he left was even more like, wow, you know, he did this for them too.
Yeah, and I love the casting for the girl that plays Egon's granddaughter.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Because the acting was perfect. It's like, oh yeah, you're definitely Egon's grandkid for sure.
Yep.
It's definitely a genetic thing in the family.
Yep. It was a great movie. It was excellent. It was excellent.
Yeah, I was surprised to find out that it was filmed in Alberta,
Canada.
Yeah, it was filmed in Alberta, Canada, because the where they filmed it in Alberta is, I guess it's, they considered it to look close enough like Oklahoma.
Mm-hmm.
Because I know when we were watching it, I'm looking at it and I thought, man, I know it's supposed to be Oklahoma, but that's fucking Alberta. Nothing against Canada. It looks great and all, but it's like, you know, it just, sometimes that drives me nuts. It's like, if you're going to have a movie that takes place in a certain place, just spend a little extra money, go there and, you know, fucking actually film it there.
Right, yeah.
Because it was with the same thing with Twister. Like, they actually went to Oklahoma and Kansas and anywhere else. They actually went to those places and filmed there in Tornado Alley.
Yep.
You know, oh, yeah. But of course, in some cases, a lot of cases, Hollywood goes to Canada because they save money that way and it's cheaper to film in Canada.
Yeah.
So, but I mean, nothing against you, Corey, or anything like that. You know, but.
Hey, guys, real quick, I gotta take care of something. A couple things. One, real quick. So because this is all like kind of, you know, just a free for all kind of thing, is there any custom spotlight or asshole of the month or no? I mean, either way, it's fine. I just want to
make sure. We can do an asshole of the month while we go around the table and ask, anyone have an asshole of the month?
I have a few.
All right, well, if I let you go first, do you promise not to drag it on too long?
Yes.
All right.
Okay, so, first off, Warner Bros. Is woke as fuck, because I know you may not be DC fans, and that's completely fine, but with me being a DC fan and collector, it pisses me off that they say no, no, no to trigger weapons, but sure, let's give a guy dressed as a bat, let's give the dude dressed as a bat some sharp projectiles he can throw that could kill someone, or let's give some chicks either a bow staff, a bat, or a mallet that if you swing at their head hard enough could kill someone. But trigger weapons are so bad. Are you serious? Because, yeah, they don't allow crossbows or guns with their figures anymore. That's why a lot of people are disappointed with the accessories on the Mafex / Joker. So that's the first asshole of the month. The second is... come on, Brian, don't... John, you and I talked about this, so... There's a Star Wars Facebook group called Tantive Trading, and you literally walk on eggshells in that godforsaken group. Like, you can't post anything with knockoffs because they have a strict no reproing rule, which is like reproducing and all that kind of stuff. So like knockoffs and, you know, okay. I'll keep the story short and sweet, but one time someone was looking for a rangefinder antenna for their, I think, 12-inch Jango Fett figure. It's probably like that old Hasbro 12-inch one. And I offered to either help find or print a rangefinder for her, for their figure. And the thing is, I get called out for reproing when I didn't, well, first of all, they didn't explain it in the rules. And if you make a rule that not everyone's heard a word for, or actually regardless, you should explain that rule, you know? So that's the first thing. Second, I didn't know what the fuck reproing is. I mean, oh, apparently reproing not only is like KOs and that kind of thing, but you can't help anyone out to get something, apparently, you know, because like I said about the rangefinder antenna, and not only that, but, you know, it's funny, they're like, they make this post like, you know, let us know what you're looking for, we'll help you out. I post about Black Series Wrecker, and you know what one of the admins said? I hope you find it. The fuck? Like, what, you can't, you can't provide a link to something that's, to a record listing that's not a pre-order or an overpriced eBay listing? Are you that fucking lazy? You know, I mean, and then we get to my last point. And that is, I mentioned one sentence about KOs, whether it be Cousin Potter or trying to get a figure that I missed out on, whether it's retail or import. And I get that comment automatically deleted. And then this Mark, I think his last name was Turner, I don't give a shit. But Mark, one of the admins, he texts me on Messenger and gets on to me about it. Well, I say get on to me about it, but essentially that's what he did. And, you know, I tried asking questions to clarify shit, and he refused, he practically refused to answer my questions. So I was like, you know what? I'm done. You know, I'm not going to walk on eggshells here. And granted, I didn't see this as part of the rules, but I could be misremembering or something. I don't know for sure. But the thing is, he, apparently, one of the rules is no cursing, and I didn't know that. And if that even was a rule, I didn't mean to. So I did apologize for that multiple times. And, you know, it's like, it doesn't matter. You know, it's like, you know, it's like, hey, where are your wardens? You follow these rules or fuck you? And it's like, no, fuck this. So, I mean, those are my two biggest assholes of the month. I think I had another one or two, but I can't remember what they were. If I did say another one, it's not really Medicom's fault, but if I did say one more, it'd probably be Medicom Toy for, you know, for the constant delays with their MCU figures. But, you know, John and I talked, and it could be that they're refining the sculpt and paint and accessories and joint tolerances. And if it's not them refining stuff, it's them making more copies for piled up pre-orders that keep coming, and possibly even, you know, and it's possibly also them trying to distribute to like AmiAmi, Hobbyland Japan, Ninden Gang, all that kind of stuff. So it's a multitude of things. So I don't really fault Medicom for that, but it's just annoying as hell waiting for a figure that you want really bad, and it's still, and it just keep getting delayed and delayed and delayed. So, and you know what? I feel like I, even though I kept it shorter than I usually would, I feel like I still rambled, so I'll just show off my custom spotlight stuff next month. So, because I do have to, get. Thank you guys. If you guys are still on and you want to do custom spotlight, if when I come back, you know, just let me know. But if not, then I'll just do it next month.
All right, sounds good, buddy.
So, all right, guys. Sorry to head out so quickly, but like I said, I got to take care of this stuff. If you guys are still on when I come back, cool. If not, then it's okay.
Sounds good, bud.
All right, I'll talk to you later.
All right, talk to you later.
All right.
Yeah.
Yep. All right, bye.
I don't know where the hell Jordan's at.
I have no idea. I messaged him.
He sent me a text message saying, oh, we had a family thing going on.
Yeah.
He lost track of time. Well, he should have said something to me a lot sooner and let me know. But, I mean, I'll give him an hour. But if not, then we'll just end
it. Right, yeah.
But if he does show up, that's fine. But he's got 1 hour, and if no show, then fuck it, we'll just call it a night.
I'm pretty sure we can come up with more shit to talk about for a fucking hour. I mean, it's really not that fucking hard to do.
No. So, anyways. Oh, fuck. So. Oh,
God.
Are you still full from yesterday's lunch?
Yes and no. It's funny. Actually, after last night, I did get hungry, and I finished up my rice and.
I did the same thing. The same thing.
And we had steak for dinner tonight, and now I'm drinking some beer.
Yeah,
but man, I'm about deep three.
Cool. Yeah.
I'm on vacation, so I have a legitimate excuse. But
there you go. Same here with me. We both go back on the 3rd, and in the meantime, just gonna relax and enjoy ourselves. So
I got like 3 Christmases this freaking next week. It's gonna be insane, dude. But all right, let's talk shop. So,
I gotta say this before I forget. Hey, Corey.
Yeah.
Yeah. When I got Breaker yesterday, when I took him out of the box, the cardboard that has like the background graphics behind the figure. If you look at it, it's Cobra Island. And then there's like multiple pterodromes scattered throughout the island, and it's not like a modern looking one. It's clearly the 80s pterodrome base.
The one you want, I guess. Eh?
Yeah, it's the one. That's kind of like my fucking holy grail or a holy grail item for my personal collection, but like besides that, everything else on Cobra Island on the picture and the graphics was like all brand new looking. It looked pretty cool.
Huh.
Yeah. So
weird how they put in with the bike instead of the van or whatever. But
yeah, I was thinking about that one time. I thought, man, it'd be kind of cool if they did like a vamp for the declassified figures. I'll admit that would be kind of cool. I mean, they've done only just 2 vehicles for that retro G.I. Joe line that came out last year.
Yeah. It makes sense for Clutch. I mean, with the bike, they could have put They could have put Rock and Roll or any other of the original 13 with them.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. What's the bike like? Really detailed, or?
Yeah, it's pretty detailed actually. It's got of course the Gatling gun on the side that you can also take off.
So it's like the ram.
Yeah, Oh yeah, I mean the bike itself, it's like, it's almost like a Yamaha mixed in with a Kawasaki, you know. It's kind of like a couple other designs mixed in, but it's mostly an upgraded version of the original one.
Nice. I like the original stuff. The colors are much better, too.
Yeah. Like, when I was putting it together last night, I was moving him into making him look like he's on the bike with his hands on the handlebars. I was surprised. I'm like, wow, this was almost like a Hollywood stop motion figure for a movie, with the way everything was detailed and felt. And I was like, damn, Hasbro, that's actually pretty good.
Oh yeah, definitely. Know. I mean, I'm very, very impressed with the G.I. Joe line. I mean, I know I only have the main characters, a trooper. You know, it's just amazing of how they took this idea and just revamped it into something new. I mean, I give you shit about it, Chris. I don't want to be an asshole, but you know, I mean, if you ever did get more in depth into the line, that's your call, man. You know, I'm just giving you a hard time. I'm not trying to be an asshole or a dick.
I'm just really picky off and on with what I want. So I think sometimes it helps to be picky, because I've got him right next to what's his name from Ghostbusters Afterlife? I've got him right next to
Egon's grandson.
Yeah, I forget his name in the movie.
I forgot too.
But I got the Plasma series of him, and Quinn got that for me as like a random little gift. She told me it was the last one the store had, and for like $23, a Plasma series Ghostbuster figure with the articulation and the detail on it, that's really good. Like, I was really surprised. Because with the detail and the articulation and how it looks, that's something you would expect to find at like a comic book shop, or you know, the place we went to yesterday in downtown Madison at Meepleton's.
Yep.
You know, it's like something you would expect to find there.
Yep. Yep. Exactly.
But finding those at a Walmart is pretty nice for a change.
Oh, definitely, especially that's you know, me being a 1/12 scale collector, I mean, I have so many imported figures. And then when I got into the G.I. Joe line, I'm like, man, these are some really good figures. I was just blown away of how articulated they are. I mean, they're modern updates of them, but man, they're cool. I mean, Cobra Commander looks great. I might get the different Storm Shadow, because the movie Storm Shadow, I mean, man, it could have been so much better. But I mean, overall, there are really good figures, and I'm glad I got the ones I wanted to get instead of going even further down the rabbit hole, you know.
Yeah. I was looking at Breaker and the Ghostbusters figure I got for the Plasma series. I was looking at them and I held one in each hand. I think what they did was they just had the same designers work on both franchises, because it feels like the same material and same texture and sculpting for the face and body. I think they just had the same people work on both franchises at Hasbro.
Yeah.
So it works pretty good. I think one of the things I really like about this Breaker figure is his helmet. His helmet looks really cool.
It does look like an ACH. I'm not gonna lie. Like, I was looking at it earlier today when I stopped by over your place for a while. I was looking at it, I'm like, man, this is actually pretty nice. I mean, I'm not saying I don't like Breaker. I just don't know a lot of the character, and I have no idea where I would put a 1/12 scale motorcycle in my collection, you know?
Yeah, I'll figure something out. But I'm kind of surprised that they didn't give him like a pistol.
Yeah, like if he could have got like had some more gear, like some sort of a weapon, like maybe a pistol or something, or I'm surprised he can't even carry that giant machine gun.
Well, I think it's because of the Gatling gun next to the bike. They probably figured, well, the Gatling gun's enough. He doesn't really need a pistol or a submachine gun, but
I think they should have
included a sidearm just for the hell of it, because it's G.I. Joe.
Yeah. One thing I do like about Breaker, though, is that the body that he has is pretty much just a basic soldier issue that he has, a basic OCIE, which is what we call, it's pretty much your gear and stuff like that. It's called OCIE. And, because he's got the kit, he's got the ACH. I mean, dude, he fucking looks ready for combat. And one of the things that's in some of the regulations that have changed now, when it's hot weather, you can actually roll up your sleeve. So he's got it down to a T, you know?
Yeah, I know. I mean, I've got him on the bike right now, and I know technically it's like a toy, but I mean, the way it's been detailed, sculpted, and positioned, I mean, it does look like something you would see in an art department for a movie in Hollywood.
Yeah.
You know, like some kind of scale model. I mean, that's how well it looks. Yeah. So, because that was the other thing, too, is, like, I looked at the declassified figures, and, like, this is basically, like, if Takara did G.I. Joe figures, this is what they would be.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
That's pretty much what they are. They're just, you know, Takara Masterpiece G.I. Joe figures.
That are reasonably priced, too, on top of that.
Yeah, well, Breaker here, I got him at Meepleton's yesterday for, like, $51.
Yep.
Which is okay. And then I know.
Okay, update time. From Jordan. He hit nasty traffic on 95, probably heading home right now.
Did you see how long it's going to take?
No, he just said, sorry, hit nasty traffic on 95. All right, let me know when you get back. We're still on.
Okay, well, if he can make it in time, we can catch up with him quick. Have him roast the Christmas photos, and then we'll just call it a night. So, but anyways, and the same thing with the Ghostbusters Plasma series. It's like Takara Masterpiece Ghostbusters figures,
mm-hmm.
with the detail and everything. So, anyways, so yeah, Breaker was like 51, and I think the other ones were like 20, 25, almost 30. So no, they're good figures, and the prices are reasonable. What's that?
There are a few bad ones. Like, it's good that you're just buying the ones you like.
Well, yeah.
Look at Baroness's bike compared to the bike you got. It's quite a difference.
Oh yeah, that's right. The Baroness came out with a bike. I forgot about that one.
Yep. I got her without the bike because I have no room for a 1/12 scale bike.
I will admit, though, I do like the Destro figure where he's got like the jacket with the leopard skin on it.
Oh, the pimp Destro.
Yeah, the pimp Destro where it looks like it's fucking 1990.
Yep.
Outfit colors that he's got going on. Yeah, the pimp Destro.
Pulled from the shelves. It was released like that in the 90s sometimes, and then they pulled it because they thought it looked so ridiculous. So there's only like a couple of them, so they're real rare and expensive.
Damn.
Oh, wow. Yeah, but like G.I. Joe in like the very late 80s and into the 90s, they were doing Hasbro was doing all kinds of crazy stuff.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, don't get me wrong, it's cool. Like, I do like the idea of Night Force and, you know, Eco Warriors and all the different variations they had. The Tiger Force, that was pretty, you know, that's kind of interesting.
Tiger Force.
I know, right? Like, the G.I. Joe Tiger Force. I can't help but when I look at the Tiger Force from G.I. Joe, I can't help but think that that straight up just looks like something that Joe Exotic would have at home from Tiger King.
Oh, God.
You know.
He should be.
What's that?
Oh, he'd make a good member to the sub team there, Tiger Force.
he'd have to be like a Cobra sub Tiger Force or something, because there's that I sent it to you a while back. There was a skit on Robot Chicken where that was great. It looked like he was joining Cobra, and then he turns around at the last minute and he fucks over G.I. Joe and Cobra.
that bitch Kara Baskins, I'm gonna go after her and kill her. So that Kara Baskin bitch. Man.
I would not mind a customized Joe Exotic Cobra figure for my collection, with like the O-ring and everything else. That would be great. Oh god, that skit was great. So yeah.
So Chris, did you have an asshole of the month or not really?
Oh man. Yeah, I do actually. My asshole of the month is just, I want to say Mother Nature for what that fucking bitch did to everyone down south with those nasty ass tornadoes, especially in Kentucky. Mother Nature, you're a fucking hoe. You're a fucking hoe. Mm-hmm. Same thing with your mama.
Mm-hmm.
Because it fucking sucks, because now all those people don't have a home, and Christmas is like a week from now already, and that's just really shitty timing for them.
Yeah.
And I know Mother Nature and those tornadoes are asshole of the month.
Mm-hmm.
Let me see. Other asshole or assholes of the month. I'm going to say, I'm going to say Walmart.
Because
they keep doing the thing where they have all those fucking registers and they still don't have enough people to work them all, and they just, you know, they got fucking lines.
I will have to completely agree with you about Walmart. So the other day before, and when I was doing Christmas shopping, right, I was like, I walked into Walmart, right, and I had to get another Christmas present for Haley, my girlfriend, right. And so I walk in there, the fucking door was moving, so opening so slow. I was like, no, fuck this. And I freaking just ripped the door right open. And you could hear the slam, right? So I'm walking down there. I just continued to walk. I think one person did look back, and nothing was said to me the entire time. And then I go get Haley's other Christmas present, right? And I'm like thinking to myself, I look at all the fucking the registers, right, where there's not a cashier in fucking sight. Because it's all automated now, I'm like thinking to myself, what kind of fucking shit is this? And on top of that, Walmart in Janesville had nothing. Nothing. I'm like, this is fucking bullshit. I'm trying to do Christmas shopping. They got nothing in this fucking store. And on top of that, you have to literally go to the register to pay automatically. I mean, yeah, with one item, yeah, I could see that, but every time you have to walk out the door, someone has to check your receipt to make sure, oh, yeah, okay, yeah, you're not stealing anything. I mean, like, it feels like that entire system was not properly thought out. I mean, I went to Walmart earlier today before I saw Chris, and I'm, like, thinking to myself, you know, I go to – because they still have interactions with people at a cash register – instead of an overwhelming amount of automated cash registers, which I think is fucking stupid. How are people supposed to have a fucking job when they got fucking shit like that, you know? It's stupid.
Yeah, well, I don't know. I just feel there's so many things that can make Walmart better, but they're not willing to take the time to make any improvements whatsoever.
Nope. Any more assholes, Chris?
No, those are really the only two I can think of right now.
Oh, God.
Oh, fuck.
I had another asshole, not just Walmart. I forgot what it was. Oh, fuck. I don't know, I would say my uncle, but he was actually not that much of an asshole today, so I'll give him this one pass. But I'd have to say life and responsibilities, that's always an asshole. But we all have to get better at it no matter how far we go in life, and we just gotta keep on moving forward. I think I come to more terms with that, because where I'm working at now and stuff like that. I mean, yeah, it's frustrating, but at the same time, I just gotta keep moving forward.
Yeah, that's fine. So, God, I got some serious dusting to do after the holiday season.
Yeah, you do, dude. Holy fuck!
It's getting nasty, but.
Yeah. What about you, Corey? Any assholes of the month, or not really?
There's got to be some Canadian assholes up there.
Too much. No, it's been pretty good, I guess. Maybe my wife, I suppose.
Oh. Wow. Whoa. Where's this coming from?
I don't know. She's just pain in the ass sometimes.
But. You still love her, though, right?
What's that?
You still love her?
Yeah, I still love her.
Yeah. I mean, I think
a lovable pain in the ass. How about that?
Yeah. it's like the same with my girlfriend. She's a lovable pain in the ass.
It's a good kind of pain in the ass.
Damn right it is.
Yeah, it's tricky, because I do love her, but. Besides her, everything else is good, so.
Come on, baby, make it hurt so good.
Nobody else makes me sweat, I guess, or gets me stressed.
Nice. So I do have a question, Canadian, regarding Canada. You guys have this thing called Boxing Day, right?
Yeah, don't you guys?
No. Well, here, explain to me, what is Boxing Day in Canada?
It's just always the day after like Christmas, so you can get shit for a discount.
That's kind of like a Black Friday.
Yeah.
So you wait till after Christmas, and then Boxing Day, everyone goes shopping. Sometimes even the snowbirds would, like, people would go to the States and do that too. And after Christmas, go shopping on Boxing Day. That's what I thought.
Oh, yeah. So that's basically like everyone gets cash or gift cards or certificates. Then the next day they go out shopping and get whatever the hell they want. So, I mean, people here stateside, we do that, but we don't call it Boxing Day. Most of that just kind of happens the day after Thanksgiving. You know, we call it Black Friday.
Yep.
So, but no, I can see people going out shopping after Christmas Day for whatever, because that too is, then it's like there's a just everything's on sale. So yeah, you gotta eat that shit up.
Yeah, there's always that. Oh no, it used to be like that anyway. I'm sure now it's cheap.
Have you gone to the Canadian Toys R Us? Is everything in the Toys R Us in Canada still flourishing?
But yeah, I go there every once in a while, maybe once every couple months, but it's They got a lot of stuff, but it's still behind.
Hello?
And there's a toy line. Everybody. Everything in the States comes out first.
Yeah. Yeah, last time I seen some YouTuber in Canada, he went to Toys R Us up there and walked right in, and everything was completely full. From floor to almost the ceiling, all the shelves right up to the edge. Everything was in stock. It was like, oh my God, they got their act together. You know, they had everything full and everything well stocked and plenty of everything and stuff on sale. And, you know.
Wait, are you talking about Toys R Us in Canada?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Canada's on my shit list because of that. Like, or not necessarily Canada, but the people at Toys R Us that let the ones in America go to hell, meanwhile, they have their shit together in Canada. Like, what the fuck, man? I mean, do they hate us over here or what?
No, it's just because the Canadian Toys R Us, the store, the Toys R Us stores in Canada were better well managed in Canada than they were here in the States. And after Toys R Us went out of business here in America, right after that, a company in Canada bought the rights for the Canadian Toys R Us, and they since then have been still in operations, you know, because they you can order stuff from their website and they'll either deliver it to you, or you can just pay for it on the website, go to the store, pick it up, or just go to the store and go shopping in person.
Well, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, I mean, that's kind of what I'm saying, because, like, you know, just, I feel like, you know, the Toys R Us management over here in the States were just like, hey, whatever you find, fuck you. And I don't understand that's kind of what I was saying. Like, you know, do they just hate their customers or what? Because, like,
no, the store, what happened was, it was kind of like what you just said, but it was more to that. It was a combination of the management at the very top of Toys R Us. They were going into debt. And they were struggling to pay off the debt, and the debt was because they weren't paying money to Mattel and Hasbro and everyone else they had business deals with. So they just kept generating all this debt that they were struggling to pay off. And it just got worse and worse over the years. And then they had to eventually file for bankruptcy, even after they got rid of a bunch of stores and laid off a bunch of people, because they thought that would work, and then they would just bring back new stores, but that didn't work either. So then they closed down even more stores, laid off a lot more people, and then eventually, they went out of business completely here in America. And the fucked up part was all the people at the corporate office, they got like these, like their last paychecks had millions and millions of dollars in them, while everyone else got, you know, like a regular paycheck that wasn't very much. And the thing that's also fucked up about it was when Toys R Us was finally closing its doors, they had to go to court to file paperwork, and a judge had signed paperwork and approved that everyone, the CEO and all these other, you know, presidents and vice presidents and all those bigwigs had approved the last paychecks that had millions of dollars on them. They had a judge that approved that, which was bullshit, because what the judge should have done was had that money divided up and given out to anyone that was still working at whatever stores were left over at the time.
Yeah, honestly, that would have been a lot better.
Well, that, and it was also competition. The other thing that put the nail in the coffin was it was competition with Amazon, Target, Walmart, and even like the small, you know, mom and dad type of toy stores that were selling vintage and new toys and collectibles. So it was pretty much going into debt, not being able to pay it off, competition from other stores that were also starting to sell toys, especially going up against Amazon and Walmart that did them in, and just bad management from the very top of the corporate office.
Man, I wish what would have happened is that, and just hear me out, because at first I was gonna say I wish they would have fired those idiots, but at the same time, but the thing is that if it came from the top, then obviously no one could have been fired, because you know it's like the top, it's like the main head honcho bosses that screwed up. I mean, am I right or am I wrong?
Well, I don't know the whole details of what was going on behind the scenes. I just know that the people that were running everything at the very top were still in charge, and they somehow walked out with their last paycheck that had well over $1 million in it. So, but however, like I said, you know, Toys R Us in Canada was, all of that was being run differently. And the original plan was they were going to go out of business, but then a different company in Canada bought the rights for Toys R Us in Canada and started running things differently up there, which, long story short, allowed them to keep the stores open and keep people working there as if nothing had ever happened. Because I've been hearing stories of people that live near the Canadian-American border. Like, they'll spend hours driving through the border into Canada just to shop at a Toys R Us in person. And then they'll drive back to America.
Man, it's such a shame. There's just, I mean, as far as, like, Toys R Us goes, it just proves like Canadians are better, you know, because it's like you said, you know, they had their shit well managed, and meanwhile over here our head honchos for Toys R Us fucking sucked over time.
Yeah, well, I don't know the exact number of Canadian Toys R Us's. I don't think they have as many as we did, but they have enough for they're still able to pay their workers and such. So
Toys R Us till later. I think you guys had them first.
Wait, what? Yeah, because Toys R Us started in America.
Oh, right, Toys R Us, right.
Yeah, because the guy that started Toys R Us, he actually served in World War II, and when he came back, he wanted to start a toy store.
I never knew that.
It's like a different store first, and then he turned it into a toy store, didn't he?
Yeah, that's what it was. I'm sorry. That's what it was.
So,
but yeah, he always wanted to.
Oh, shit. Motherfucker. Oh, God damn it. So,
but
you mind if I duck out, guys? I got to do a few things before my wife gets home from work or whatever and clean up a bit. But
that's completely understandable, Corey. You have a Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, and we'll keep on talking, buddy. All right.
Yeah,
take it easy.
Yeah, it's great to have you back, bud.
All right. Merry Christmas, guys. Take care.
Merry Christmas, buddy. Take care.
Yeah, Merry Christmas, right. Corey. See ya.
Yeah.
Yep. See you, Corey.
Yep. Bye.
Now there.
And then there were four.
That's exactly what I was about to say.
Yeah, come on, Jordan. You got half an hour. Where the fuck are you?
God damn it, Jordan. You fucking piece of shit. Fuck, bro.
So I really wish he had told me he had something going on.
Yeah, if he had something going on, if he had something going on, it would have been more understandable. But
Well, it could have been last minute, you know.
Well, that's just it. If it was an emergency, like, okay, then that's fine. You can just tell us later what was going on. But whatever. Anyways, we seriously need some jokes in here right now.
Okay, all right. So Chris, yesterday when we were fucking up in Madison, want to tell the story about the comment I made?
Which comment?
While we're eating, and I said this comment about, like, was it dead happy?
Oh, so we're in the fucking sumo. We just get done eating lunch, and we're so stuffed and full. I don't know. You said something like drop dead happy.
Yes, yes. That's
like,
what
oh,
it was.
I'm so drop full. I could just drop dead happy. And I thought that sounded really funny. Like, it just sounds like a comedy from the movie. Oh, drop dead happy coming this Friday. You know, it just sounds like the title of a comedy from the 90s. Drop Dead Happy. You know, like a fucking Ernest movie. Ernest drops dead happy.
That was fucking great. That was
yeah, but God, damn, that fucking food we had. We had so much.
Fucking
so
amazing.
Good.
Oh, my Lord. I told Haley about the guys' night we had last night and stuff like that. And, you know, we were talking like, man, we were so fucking full. It was insane. And it was a fucking great day, man. And then we were talking and I was like, man, you know what? I wish Chris, we were talking like, man, I wish Tyler was here, you know, like it probably would have been fucking even better if the three of us were hanging out.
Yeah, because we thought it'd be cool if Tyler lived in Madison and we just pick him up somewhere and we just, you know, three of us go shopping and wherever else in Madison for the day, and then when we're done, we just drop him off. That'd be cool if you did live in Madison, but it's all right.
Oh. All right. So.
Yeah, it would be cool. Maybe someday, though.
Yeah. All right. Chris? But I'm surprised Hanson didn't buy anything at Meepleton's yesterday. I can't believe he came out empty-handed.
Yeah, I know. It was just weird because I was looking around. I was looking around to see if they had any Marvel Legends figures I was looking for the, like, either it would have been a Groot or something else or something that I don't have in my collection. But I'm, like, looking around, like, man, they had nothing. I like Meeps. He's got some good stuff. But, I mean, like it was just, I was just out of the loop. And then when we went to pre-played, like, I was thinking about purchasing that DVD box set. I'm like, wait a second, I can watch this on Netflix anytime I want, you know? And then it was just weird that I usually, like, come home with something, but I think I just needed a day just to get away from everything and just hang out with a buddy. I think it's what I needed more than anything, honestly, you know?
Oh, just get out of town for a bit?
Yeah, just get out of Broadhead. Get away from all the stress and bullshit, you know? I mean, just to be able to relax and have some fun. And I think that's why I needed more than just to buy stuff, you know?
No, that's what I did, like, 2 weeks ago when I went to go pick up the Firehouse set. Like, I just went up there to get that and just, you know, the Boba Fett figure and just drive out of town for a while and just take, like, a mental breather.
Oh, yeah, definitely, you know, definitely. It was fucking great, man.
Yeah, dude. So, how do you fucking remove somebody from this?
The chat? Or the...
Yeah, because I figured I'd have Corey leave the group since he's done for the night.
Okay, but anyways, I'm gonna... Tyler, open if you can open the chat. There is a terrible Christmas photo. I just decided to look at terrible Christmas photos on online.
What the fuck?
I have no. This lady. This. I feel so sorry for that little child right there. I mean.
Like, oh, that child looks traumatized.
She looks like a fucking Who from the Grinch Stole Christmas.
And she wearing
glasses. As if she had it hard enough. Look at her mother wearing the most non-festive outfit I've ever seen. Gold and blue leggings. And then look at this nerd of a father she has. I mean, his pants are hiked up more than a freaking... I don't know. I can't even come up with an acronym of that. It's just mind-boggling. I mean, I'm pretty sure his nuts went back into his body, like reverse puberty, just to freaking have those pants that high. It's terrible.
Honestly, it looks like his kiwis went up into his pelvis. So yeah. And honestly, dude, like, okay. It kind of looks like you, John. Like, for some reason, it just kind of looks like you.
Yeah, I honestly thought Jordan photoshopped that shit. And put your face on it. Wow. It does look like he almost put your face on it.
Oh, that's fucked up, bro. But knowing Jordan, he would do something like that.
Oh, of course. He'll do that shit in a heartbeat. It's like, how the hell do you do that so fucking fast, dude?
Honestly...
I wonder what the discussion was for this photo. Be like, honey, I wear the pants of this family. So what you're going to do, you're going to hike them up so hard that you simulate that you have a vagina. And I'm going to hold our daughter right here and sit in the chair because I make all the money.
Oh, my God.
Oh, God. It's like... Like, does your oh my god, it's just that kid is just hard to look at. It's like there's just everything. The hair is wrong, the glasses are wrong, the dress is wrong, everything is wrong here. My god, like, I'm not a fashion expert, but damn.
Are you guys ready for this next one though?
Yes,
I found this one. Look at these miserable fucks. I mean, look at these motherfuckers.
Oh, like, my God.
Like, this got this JC looking motherfucker in this black outfit. He's like, I fucking hate my life. I want to go home.
I want to drink this bottle
of brandy or Jack Daniels that's right on the table. Oh, my God. Look at the lady. She's like, why are we doing this? It's like, man, that is the most miserable looking photo I've ever seen.
That's terrible. Oh my god.
Oh my god, Chris, you got any feedback on that?
Hold up, let me. I'll show you one of the ones I got. Hold up. Check this one out. Hello, boys.
Oh my god.
I'm sorry if I offend anyone on this one. Looks like the gay pride decided to invade Christmas and have an entire gay ugly sweatshirt contest.
Dude, that's cold.
The
impression I get from the two guys in the front here, it's like, with the footwear they got going on, the impression I get is like they both have some kind of a foot fetish. I don't know what the deal is with the guy in the green sweater, but the meth must be just starting to kick in.
Dude, he looks like he's on something. He looks fucking high. Like the dude with the dude out towards the left. Behind the two that's sitting down, like he looks high as fuck, man. Like he's just enjoying life and being so damn goofy that even if he looks ridiculous, he doesn't give a fuck.
Well, the ones I got here are pretty good, and I want to save them for Jordan. So I'm gonna show at least Dude, I'm gonna show at least one more.
Can I do one real quick before you go on? All right. Look at this one.
Oh my god! What the fuck? Why?
It looks like JC just was packed up in a box. He's like, and his wife opens like, "Hey, honey, I'm here." Just like
Jesus. Also, Chris, that's a very fucked up one. I mean, it looks like it looks like the dad is he grew twice his height and is terrorizing his family to participate in family Christmas photos. Like, that's what it looks like right here. Technically
photoshopped.
I know, but that's what I'm saying. Like, whoever photoshopped this made it look like the dad grew like 2 to 3 times his height and is just scaring the shit out of his family to participate in Christmas.
It looks like a horror movie cover.
Yeah,
exactly. Like,
that horror movie. It'd be like the Christmas story, right? With that one guy. It looks like that would be him as a father. And just be like a Christmas Story part two, Santa's Revenge or Santa's Horror, some shit like that, where he's like a Santa Claus who just goes in the wild and just slaughters caribou or reindeer and feeds it raw to his family just to try to spread the Christmas cheer or something. Oh God, that is terrible.
Well, some people, they know they do it just for fun, like they do it purposely, and then some people and then some people they'll do a Christmas photo and they don't mean it to be embarrassing, but then it's like, oh yeah, it really is embarrassing when they look back at it.
Yeah.
Okay, I gotta say something about this one that John just sent. It looks like, okay, let's say it's Lady Deadpool in an alternate universe as a child, and she has a twin sister. If that was the case, the one flipping you off is young Lady Deadpool as a child, and that's her twin just thinking, bro, what the fuck is wrong with you?
I was thinking more of this, like, you know, Santa's probably thinking to himself, well, that little girl's gonna get a lump of coal in her freaking stocking.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hey, little girl, what do you want for Christmas? You know what? Fuck you, Santa.
Like, alright, damn, you little shithead, you're getting coal for Christmas. You're lucky I'll throw in some switches so your parents can beat your ass.
Damn. Nice.
So here's my question to pass on the time. What do you guys think you're going to get for Christmas? Just name one item you think you might get for Christmas this year.
I could reveal some questionable information about maybe a little bit of,
I know what you're saying.
Probably this upcoming next week, more than likely. But honestly, I think Haley did give me something for Christmas. I don't know what she got me. I mean, I'm going to be very, very surprised. And I already know I'm getting Christmas for my mom, because she is the terrible person to hide Christmas presents. So story time. Anyways. So we found, because Chris actually saw what we're working on over here. They were making a four-season porch and stuff like that. But
I forgot to ask you about that yesterday.
Yeah, so Matt, Dad, and I've been helping myself. We're doing a four-season porch. So they were doing some raking underneath the porch, and they found a newspaper that was dated back to the '60s.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so I'm like, no, they're like, you know, I think my mom suggested put it, or it was either my mom or my sister, like, hey, put it up upstairs in mom and dad's room, because it was a full newspaper, right? I have to look at the date again. But I go upstairs, I see two bags of Black Rifle coffee and a Black Rifle coffee tumbler on my mom's dresser. I'm like thinking to myself, man, I already got, but I don't know what the tumbler looks like, so I really hope it's something really cool. But at the same time, it's like, man, that is the worst spot to hide a Christmas present.
Yeah, really. And it's, my sister had that happen over years ago. This is back when I was a little kid, and it was one of her years in high school. She was doing this paper. She had to do a report for school, and she had to go downstairs in the basement to get something for it. And back in the day, our basement of our house, you walk down the stairs, and the first thing you'd see was like the washer and dryer, the furnace, and then at the far end of the basement, the end of it, we had these wooden shelves for storage. So she walked all the way to these wooden shelves. She was looking for something she needed for school, and she accidentally stumbled across everyone's Christmas presents. She accidentally stumbled across the ones that she was getting for Christmas, and I forgot what she told me what they were, but she was like, she saw, she didn't say anything, and she just looked at them, and she just thought, oh, I'm going to have to pretend to like this now, aren't I? So here comes Christmas. Yeah. Here comes Christmas. And she's like, oh, thanks, mom and dad. Oh, this is great. Putting on a fake smile and everything. It's like, yeah, I guess maybe not go in the basement and not hide. I guess my mom didn't hide them very well.
But I mean,
and then I know my parents, either it was some random part of the basement that they figured no one else is going to look around in, or it's always like, I don't know, in like cardboard boxes in the far points, farthest corner of an attic or a closet somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't know, like, whatever. God, Jordan, where the hell are you?
I have no idea, man. So, back on the topic, Chris. What do you think you're getting for Christmas?
I think one of two things. I think I might get a new computer chair.
Nice.
I might also be getting. It's just a theory, and if I don't get it, that's fine. I might be getting maybe like a diesel locomotive for my train set.
Okay, nice. What about you, Tyler?
Yeah.
Okay, so real quick before I tell you, I actually have a similar story to for sure Chris's sister. So. Basically, I can't remember what I was getting, but I was getting something from the closet of my parents' bedroom in the previous house we lived in before my parents got divorced. And like I said, I can't remember what I was getting out of there. Maybe it was a towel. Maybe it was my clothes. I don't know. Maybe I was dropping off my clothes to be washed. But either way, I was getting or dropping off something, and I did not mean to, but... I look, but at the corner of my eye on the floor, the corner of my right eye, excuse me, I catch something in bubble wrap, and it was a Transformers Prime Robots in the Skies Soundwave, and that caught me from looking at it, and like I said, I didn't even mean to look at it. I didn't even know what it was, and then I saw it, and I was like, you know, so that was a little awkward, not gonna lie, but it was still really cool, and you know, but as far as what I might be getting for Christmas, though, I'm definitely thinking I'm getting Black Series Wrecker from my dad, because, you know, because Wrecker's the only Bad Batch clone I need for my core four Bad Batch mm-hmm. squad. And then all I gotta do is just wait for the Bad Batch version of Echo and then Omega to come out. And then I'll have the entire team. But as of right now, all I need is Wrecker, and then they're done, at least from before the Clone Wars story arc, so to speak. And I know for sure I'm getting a Elegoo FDM printer, because what's funny is, so, and I say this because it's funny, like, I opened the door and Elegoo just didn't even put the box in another box or anything like that to hide what it was. It was just flat out the Elegoo printer box. I'm like, and I just thought to myself, oh, this is cool. And, or something along those lines. So, you know, I mean, don't get me wrong. Like, I'm still, you know, going to be like, you know, wow and all that kind of stuff, you know, happy to get in that kind of thing, because, you know, Elegoo does make some good 3D printers. I recently was watching Uncle Jesse on YouTube, and he actually says that his favorite brand is Elegoo. So if he says it, it must be pretty good. Those are two things that I'm pretty sure I'm going to be getting. Well, one that I'm pretty sure, and the one that I'm positive, I guess. Mm-hmm. I don't know, but as far as what my mom might be getting me, I have no clue. It might just be a bunch of clothes, which is fine because I need clothes anyway. But from Nana, probably Forza Horizon 5, because that game recently came out like a month or two ago, and I have been wanting to get the game and play it, but, you know, no job, so can't get it, and all kind of stuff.
That's why we have Christmas.
Christmas, birthdays, mm-hmm. a couple other special occasions, you know, but... But at any rate, I'm positive I'm going to get the game from Nana because I asked Mom, you know, hey, does Nana need any idea, or you know what? No, she told me that Nana needed ideas for me for Christmas, and and I basically just told her that all I really want is Forza Horizon 5, because really and truly, there really isn't a lot that she can give me that I could ask for from her right now, especially with all the shipping and, you know, some of it having price hikes and that kind of thing. It's just like, you know, so...
Yeah. I do have a question for John, though. Hey, John, did your dad go on vacation or something? I just got this picture of him.
Oh, wow.
Wow. What the fuck? Bro.
Mr. Hansen, what are you doing here?
Oh my god. Oh, that's funny. Jesus, that. Oh my god.
Oh shit. Fuck. Oh, God. Well, it's pretty much... oh, shit. Well,
So I guess I don't know if we're gonna close out here, but what do you guys consider the best all time Christmas movie?
Well,
it could be animated, it could be live action, it could be like whatever. It's a free for all.
Honestly, like, I really don't know.
God damn it.
Because Iron Man 3, like, I mean, if you were to consider Iron Man 3 a Christmas movie, I would say that. Because it is a pretty good Iron Man movie, despite, you know, all the whole Mandarin drama that people hated. Honestly, I have to say that because I can't really, because I don't really know any other Christmas movies. And I have not seen Die Hard, and yes, I know I need to see Die Hard. Yes, I know I'm uncultured. You can tell me any and
everything. You're uncultured swine. Fucking piece of shit.
I know. I'm a fucking piece of shit. I know.
How dare you not see one of the greatest Christmas movies of all time? Die Hard is a fucking legendary Christmas movie. I swear to fucking God, Tyler. I swear to God, you piece of shit.
Yes, I know I'm a piece of shit. Thank you. Actually, one of my favorite movies is Merry Christmas, Drake and Josh.
Okay, that's not a bad movie. I mean, it is a Christmas movie, but yeah, I mean, that's pretty good back in the day.
Yeah, plus Drake and Josh is fun.
Oh, Tyler, did you hear what happened to the guy that plays Josh?
Drake.
Drake. I'm sorry, Drake.
Drake Bell, I heard that he was accused of being into like 16-year-olds or something like that.
Yeah, apparently he was talking with a 16-year-old, basically inappropriate texting and pictures, and he had to go to court for it earlier this year, and the deal came out to he had to do community service and a restraining order was put against him and he's not to have any contact whatsoever with the 16-year-old that he was talking with. And I was not expecting that. Like, damn, dude, really? I wasn't expecting that, and I wasn't also expecting him. While this was going on, I didn't know, and neither did anyone else know that he's married and he's already got a kid.
Yep.
It's like,
oh, wait, hold up. So he's married with a kid and he's still hitting on a 16-year-old?
Well, he was, but now he's not allowed to have any contact with this 16-year-old, whoever it was.
Okay, let me revise that question then. So when he was hitting on the 16-year-old, he was still married with a kid?
Mm-hmm.
I think that's what it was. I don't know the specifics of the, you know, like chronological events of a timeline or anything like that.
Right.
But I do know at the time where he had to go to court for the hearing, it was revealed at the time that he is married and has a kid.
Well, if he was texting that 16-year-old while still married with a kid, it's like, dude, get some help. I mean,
yeah,
that's one of the reasons why I never want to move to Hollywood, because then
there's something about Hollywood that fucks you up. It just fucks people up.
Exactly. Oh, yeah. Yeah, Hollywood will fuck you up, you know, whether you realize it or not. Hollywood, you move to Hollywood, and then you think, okay, everything's good. Next thing you know, you're having all these sick thoughts, and you're like, and everyone's like, damn, what happened? And then,
yep. So back on the back on the topic of Christmas movies, Chris, what about you?
Well, hold that thought. I gotta get some water. I'll be right back. Hang on.
Oh yeah, I'll be right back. I gotta take a piss.
All right, I'll just sit here alone. Oh, and I don't know about you guys, but I'm doing a Star Wars marathon to prep myself for a book of Boba Fett. And you know, you may hate me for it, you may not hate me for it. Either way, I don't care. I'm doing it all in the order of the story.
All right, I'm back. So, Christmas movie for me. Let's see. well, for years I always said Home Alone, but I think it's going to have to be Christmas Vacation.
Nice. And you know what? I forgot about Home Alone. That is a really good one, too.
Yeah, you know one of the crazy things about Home Alone that most people didn't notice when it came out was Joe Pesci's got a wedding ring on in the whole movie.
And he played which one?
He played Harry. He played Harry.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, in the whole movie, he's got a wedding ring on.
Oh, I didn't know that.
But I don't know. I don't know if he was actually married at the time or if he was just wearing that as part of his character.
It could be either or. Like, either way, it makes sense, what I'm trying to say, because Harry would steal something like that to wear for himself, and...
What happened? What did I miss?
Oh, we're talking about Home Alone and Christmas Vacation.
Oh, fuck yeah, I love Christmas Vacation. Honestly, I think that's one of my favorites. Oh, great movie.
It is a great movie.
Joy to the world! Then, hey, Merry Christmas, your shitter's full.
Yeah, they're outside looking at all the lights, and he just turns like, Eddie? Merry Christmas, Clark.
Yeah.
You know, I use the microwave and I turn it on, and then I forget who the hell I am for half an hour. You know, but if this side gets dented, well, then my hair just don't look right.
Cousin Eddie is my favorite. God, he's hilarious in those movies.
Oh, fuck yeah, dude! I just picked up today at Walmart. I got a Christmas ornament. It's Cousin Eddie's RV.
Oh no way!
Uh-huh.
Oh, dude. I guess I know what to look for next time. I'm at a Walmart.
It's only $7.
Oh, that's not bad.
And for an ornament, that was pretty decent.
Especially, you know what it represents, too, on top of that. But,
Yeah.
So,
I have to say it's Christmas Vacation because as an adult now, I understand it. Like, I understand.
Oh, yeah.
Completely. Like, the relatives getting gifts, going out shopping.
Yep.
You know, expectations. Your expectations go high and doesn't go to plan and you just get pissed off. And so,
you know, I'm sorry to interrupt, but I got to say real quick one thing about it. I have seen Christmas Vacation for the first time when I was helping my mom, brother, and stepbrother decorate the put up and decorate the tree and in the living room. And I got to say, man, I didn't catch all of it, but I caught most of it, and it is a very fun movie.
It's hilarious. I mean, Tyler, if you ever get the chance to actually sit down and watch it, just watch it all the way through. It's a classic Christmas movie, and you know, and then you got these different characters, and then you got the Audrey and Rust predicament in those movies on top of that, but. Overall, it is a great movie. It's hilarious.
Well, that's awesome. I'll definitely have to. I'll have to definitely sit down and watch it from start to finish. At some point before the holiday season's over.
Yeah, definitely. So my next question is, Chris, how much longer do you want to give Jordan?
Give him till 10:15, and if he's not here by then, or at 10:15, we're wrapping it up.
All right, sounds good, man. Sounds good.
I just wish he would have said something to me, like, "Hey, something come up."
Hey, no, shit happens, man. We're out of control of it.
Yeah. Well.
So.
But.
I know if I ask this next question, it will be nonstop for a lot of people. And actually, I think I'll just save it for the January show. I'll save it for the January show. I mean, because I think for January of next year, I'm pretty sure we'll be talking a lot about what the top five figures of 2020 was. So we'll save that for next show. We'll save that for the next show.
That's yeah, and I think we should also talk about, like, who we want to try to get on for a guest next time. Yes. I was thinking we still need to do Archie Cunningham.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely. And I think Archie. I think it would be cool if we could get Dustin Anderson from TKO on. He's a pretty cool dude.
Yeah, D.A. I still like D.A. He's pretty cool. He's pretty chillax.
Yeah,
I think we should try at least get, I don't know, maybe I should try to put a little more effort in trying getting Jobby on. I'm gonna put this plug in. All right, anyone who listens to the F-Team podcast, and anyone who wants to hear Jobby the Hong be on this show, like, comment, and or subscribe, and we can see what we can do to get him on the show. There's my plug right there.
Well, are you friends with Yul LeBlanc?
Yeah, I am. I'm friends with Yul. Yeah, he's a cool.
Yul's a pretty cool guy too.
Yeah, I love talking to him. Definitely Yul, because it's funny that he was in the army too.
Yeah, we should get him.
We'll definitely have to get Yul LeBlanc on. The Yul Jobby, if we can. Tyler, I know we should try to get at least D-Amazing on. If not D-Amazing, then Daredevil 19. If not one of those guys, we'll have to find someone in the 112 skill community.
I think I did mention this earlier, but I did text Peyton, AKA Star Wars Garden on Instagram. While he is doing his own thing tonight, As long as I keep him updated, he's down to be on the next episode. And trust me, like I highly recommend checking out his Instagram because he does amazing customs and photography. He and I are a lot alike because, you know, we both not only with our photography and our custom figures, but also, and this is one thing I forgot about for Asshole of the Month, which it's only going to be briefly touched on. Hasbro being fucking stupid with their Rancor crowdfunding, because the Rancor was solid. Like, the Rancor figure itself was solid as hell. A lot of us wanted a Rancor. Like, I didn't back it, but I would love to have a 1/12 scale Rancor that's as poseable as possible like that. But unfortunately, that's not going to happen because, you know, Hasbro wanted to be stupid and first give us a Gamorrean Guard, which, you know, is fine, but that should not have been the first tier. And then when they wanted to give us like a cardboard diorama and bones, like, you know, I understand that cardboard would have been a cheaper way to make the dio, but I mean, that should not have been. That should have just been included as is with the price of, like, I think it was, what, $300, something like that?
Mm-hmm. Here's how I see it with the Rancor. I think the Rancor was good, but instead of it being a cardboard backdrop, like, go the extra mile and make it into, like, a plastic playset diorama type of display.
But that's
too.
The thing, though. I mean, don't get me wrong. I see what you're saying, but the thing is that, the Rancor itself could have probably been like $50 to $100 less. But that extra $50 to $100 comes in probably because, and I could be wrong here. So if I am wrong, I apologize. But not only the materials and time and all that kind of stuff that went into the Rancor, but it's also probably the licensing fee for Disney and Lucasfilm as well. I mean, again, I could be wrong here, but I have a feeling that that's at least a small part of why the Rancor was $300. For the Kickstarter, which, I mean, again, I don't have a problem with that, but when you have a tier that's the same figure they released at least twice already, but this time a third, but for the third time, is on a retro style card back with a coin, and then you want to throw in bones and then a cardboard backdrop, like, and again, I get a cardboard backdrop is easier to produce, but if they really wanted to, you know, get it backed, I do agree it should have been made of plastic and sculpted. Like, it should have been sculpted plastic. One or two things had to have happened. Either one, They just didn't give a shit and just thought, hey, we'll make it easier and cheaper and do cardboard. Or two, they tried to do the sculpted plastic route, but it ended up being too costly, so they couldn't do it. Those are my theories. And it is cool that they brought in a completely resculpted Return of the Jedi Luke for a tier, but that should have been the first tier. And they should have brought in the Rancor Keeper. They should have brought in Ula, you know, and maybe another one or two. And maybe towards the end, throw in the Gamorrean Guard, you know?
The pig guy?
Yeah.
The green piggy?
Called Yes, the green pig people are called Gamorrean guards.
The oinky oinkies. I wonder if they taste like. I wonder if they taste like bacon.
Probably.
Yeah, piggy.
I would not be surprised. They probably, if they do taste like bacon, it's probably that shitty kind of bacon, you know, like probably vegan bacon or whatever. I don't know.
I mean, technically, they're made out of flesh. It's flesh, dude. Well, I'm pretty sure.
It's a joke because they're green. Okay, leave me alone. Okay. Shut up.
Okay, I'll shut up. I'm sorry, buddy. It's okay.
It's okay.
Do I need to give you a cookie to make you feel better?
Do I need to come over to Wisconsin and kick your ass?
I like to come and sit.
Oh, that's fun. But yeah, I mean, those are, like I was saying, you know, those are my theories as to why the Rancor tanked. But back to the original point before I completely went off the rails. I apologize for that.
So you guys talking about the Rancor thing, right?
Well, I'm sorry, my earbud died. So
you're good.
What I'm trying to get at is, Peyton and I, we have similar views about the Rancor and the Star Wars team at Hasbro. We love the Black Series figures they produce, but we don't like it when they act stupid and do stupid things that either hurt us as collectors, I'm still not over those Clone Wars. I'm still not over those Clone Wars vehicles. Clone Wars those Black Series Clone Wars figures, I'm still not over them being Target exclusives. And I'm sure a lot of collectors and fans aren't. And for those out there that feel that way, I feel you, man. You know? But yeah, he and I have a lot of the same thought process on Hasbro and how they deal with things, at least the Star Wars team. So, you know, like I say, he's a really cool dude. Again, highly recommend checking out his Instagram. It's Star Wars Garden, but it's star.wars.garden. That's how he has it. That's how he has his username on Instagram. In fact, you know what? I'm going to link his Instagram in the chat because, again, he has some great stuff. Not going to lie.
Got it. There we go. Well, Chris, what do you say, bud?
Well, I think Hasbro put more, for whatever reason, I think they put more time and effort into the Skystriker HasLab, because once they reached enough backers for the Skystriker itself, then they started adding in extra stuff to sweeten the deal.
Mm-hmm.
They started adding in, the G.I. Joe O-ring figures, and a new Scarlet figure, a new reissue of Cobra Commander, Cobra Trooper, and a flight crew for the Skystriker to load it up and have it sent off on its way. You know, like in Top Gear, the guys working on the flight deck. You know, with they're directing traffic and getting the jets ready to take off. Like, they threw in two new figures and a co-pilot for Ace for the Skystriker. Like, they were throwing all the stuff in at the last minute to keep sweeten the deal. And I think they put more energy with that than they did with the Rancor.
Mm-hmm.
for some reason. So I'm wondering if maybe Hasbro just had two different teams with two different management groups, you know, in charge of the Rancor HasLab and the Skystriker HasLab back, you know, thing. Because it seemed like I was following it on Twitter and Facebook, and it seemed like it wasn't going to happen with G.I. Joe. And then in the last minute, they got enough backers to where they reached their goal. And then they kept going for like another couple of days, and then they finally called it quits. Which, for the price that they were asking, they were asking for like $230 for it. And I thought, well, shit, that's a really good deal. If I had the money, I would have put money down for it, you know, and tried the HasLab for once. Because I thought, well, if I had done that, and when I get the Skystriker and everything else, I'd hang it up in my room. And then I thought, I'd just give you one of my Skystrikers as a gift.
Okay.
But since I didn't put money down for the HasLab projects, that's not going to happen. But looking back now, it's like, yeah, if I had the money for it, I would have done it. Because, I still love the original Skystrikers, but this new one looks great. It's very well detailed. And it even comes with a bunch of accessories, and it comes with, like, the little, like, tractor that pulls a tank full of fuel to refuel it. And it also comes with another trailer for it that can carry rockets and missiles on it to load into. So yeah, they were doing all these little things here and there to really sweeten the deal for everybody.
Oh yeah, definitely.
So, but yeah, dude. So I don't know, but I do think it's odd, and I'm wondering if you guys noticed this. I do find it odd that HasLab keeps doing things that either get killed or destroyed or blown up in some way. If you think about it, they've done Unicron, they did Jabba's Sail Barge, they did that one giant robot from X-Men, and they did Unicron, they did...
They did
the Rancor.
They also did the Star Saber from Transformers Victory. And I find it kind of odd that back in, because I had MP24, aka the Mashpee Star Saber, and then I got the Iron Trance Star Saber. I look at that project, I'm thinking to myself, this is a miniaturized version of the masterpiece figure that has really a very little luster, unlike of that. The masterpiece didn't have a lot of luster to it either. Like the Iron Trans Starblade, aka the third-party Star Saber I have, has that luster, that right look. And then you have this HasLab that it got all the backers. It's got all the effects, the shields. I'm like thinking to myself, this is like almost a $230 fucking figure. That is almost the price I paid for Iron Trans Starblade, where it has better posability, better look, and on top of that, it feels good in hand. I mean, it's like they could have put a lot. I mean, yeah, they included that with Victory Leo, but they could have actually put a little more effort into the design of the figure and actually give it more of a luster finish. Then maybe I would have backed the project. But after I saw those photos, I'm like, this is shit. This is pathetic. Why are you even fucking trying? I was in complete disbelief and awe when I saw that. I was pretty disappointed.
Yeah. So. Did anyone here see the new South Park special?
No, I haven't yet. No, I gotta watch it.
Man, you guys suck.
In South Park, so
Wait, what did you say?
Man.
I'm not really into South Park, so...
You fucking piece of shit.
Oh, my God. God dude, damn. It's funnier than hell.
Well, yes, I know I'm a piece of shit, and, I mean, I've seen... Okay, when I say I got the gist of it, I'm sure either you or someone's going to tell me I don't, but I've seen gameplay of the Fractured Butthole game for South Park, and I didn't even finish it because it was just, like, not for me. Like, I mean, yeah, it was funny. It's just, I don't know, something about it's just not for me. I know, you're disappointed. I don't care.
That's fine. It's not the first time I've been disappointed.
Damn,
Chris. It'll be all right.
Chris, go to your happy place. Go to your happy place. Okay, buddy. It's
all right. Hashtag South Park sucks. Okay, I'm kidding.
You better watch that tone, bud.
You're not the first person to dislike South Park.
True.
South Park is the funny thing on this planet.
Dude, we're not trying to hold a gun to you. We don't want you to think that. It's just that we were just giving you a hard time, man.
I know. I'm just fucking with y'all.
Nah, you're good, bud. Oh shit!
Just not in a gay way where I'm wanting a sword fight with my penis.
Oh come on, that's such a good time. Just sword fighting.
Jesus Christ!
Yes, I know Jesus Christ.
Oh God.
Well, I'd say we should just wrap it up.
Yeah. Because I don't think Jordan's going to make it.
No.
We'll bitch at him later down the road. We'll just eat him apart. We'll wait till January. We'll just say, hey, Jordan, fuck you.
Yeah.
Motherfucker. Yeah, well, he's definitely asshole of the month for next month.
Yeah, for not showing up. Unless he has a good, reasonable explanation for it. If he does, then he will be forgiven.
Yeah, I mean, if it's a family thing, I mean, I can see there's some sort of justification there in itself.
Well, I mean, I thought earlier y'all said that he couldn't make it because of a family thing.
Yeah, he couldn't make it because of a family thing. Saying then he ended up in traffic, and it's bad traffic.
Oh.
Yeah, so... Well, I'm pretty sure he'll tell us later down the road, unless it's something personal he doesn't really want to talk about.
Yeah.
And
obviously, if it's something personal, then you know that's completely fine if he doesn't want to share it.
Yep.
But
because we may be assholes, but we're not that big of an
asshole.
Yep. That's fine. So. Well, probably gonna wrap this up. So, if you've been listening, thank you for joining us. Happy holidays, Merry Christmas,
and have a happy new year.
I'd like to thank Tyler Pickup, aka Starpool, for coming on. I'd like to thank the Jack Nerd, aka John Hansen, and I'd also like to thank our tech support, Dan Wygon, aka Lieutenant Dan. Thank you guys for joining me. Sorry we didn't have our good buddy Jordan to do the roasting of embarrassing Christmas photos like we did last year, so we'll see what's going on with him.
I mean, we tried. We tried to roast some Christmas photos. We tried, but Jordan has a way of it. That he has a certain je ne sais quoi of roasting Christmas photos.
Yeah, he's got the power.
Honestly, what we may need to do next time is, well... I don't know if we'll have a Christmas special for next year, but if we do...
Nope.
Nope.
Yeah, that's right. Because
the show will be on hiatus, but at the same time, we'll try to keep the show alive, and we'll figure it all out as long as you guys keep in touch with me, and we'll keep going forward from there.
Yeah, absolutely. And if we do a Christmas special next year, or something for Christmas or whatever, we'll probably have to do it a bit earlier, because I think because we did it towards the end of the month, or in anywhere between the middle to the end of the month, everyone's just gotten so busy with like family stuff and all that. I mean, I could be wrong, but I think that's why this year hasn't been as great as last year, because I think last year we did it, I want to say earlier, if not after Christmas. So maybe if we do something next year, we should try maybe a bit earlier in the month or something.
Yeah, we'll figure out something. We always do.
Yeah. We're big brains. It's not small brains.
Damn right. Well, guys, it's always a pleasure. It's always a joy talking with all y'all. I am going to finish my beer, do some other things tonight, take a fucking shower, do some other things that shall not be mentioned, and fuck yeah.
Well, you enjoy doing those unspeakable things.
Yeah, I'm gonna murder this fucking I'm gonna murder something. I'm gonna destroy something. I don't know. I might make a stop motion and kill more Asgardians. Who knows? Oh God, cut that part out. That was terrible. I mean, I don't know. I'm being very like melodramatic right now.
That's all right. I'm melodramatic all the time. You get used to it.
Yeah. Well, anyways, that's about it. Chris, anything else?
No, we're done.
Fuck yes.
So, all right. Well, thanks, guys, for joining me. Have a Merry Christmas, and we're out.
We're out.